So a little history. First of all, the younger guys have it good because they didn't experience the old stuff from Obadi 1 when they first came out. In fact, you know, when computerized vehicles first came out, you could talk about 75, 76 Seville. There was no codes to be had. There was no scanner to be had. You had to know about numbers. You had no voltage specs. You had no ohm specs. So everything was done on levels. So if you had a drivability problem, you basically had to go right to the ECM. And back then they had breakout boxes. That was a big thing. Our interface harnesses. So basically you take the connector out of the ECM, put it into here, put this connector into the ECM, and this went into a breakout box, and you did all your pinout checks. That's the way it was done. Or you can back probe. Because, you know, when you unplug a connector, sometimes you can get rid of the problem that was there if it was a bad connection at the ECM. But that's the way it was done. So you have to go down the line and check all your main sensors and just probe with a voltmeter, ohm meter, checking stuff, and also use an amp meter and ground stuff. There were no codes to be had. And then I would say the first company to really kick in was, there were companies back then, Brainmaster was one. It was all test company. And it was also OTC started, I think, in early 80s. Snap-on didn't actually kick into like 88. So in the early days, there wasn't much options. Because if you really look at it, GM started in 1980 and a half with codes and data. And Ford didn't start data until like 89 on the higher-end cars. And Chrysler was there 83 and a half, GM 80 and a half, Chrysler like 89. And the European cars didn't have codes and data that early. So with the European cars, it was a little tough. So you're still going in there and probing wires. And a lot of manufacturers, some of the Asian cars, when they started, it was just a code. The only time you got a code is if you had something that was open or shorted. If it was anything in between, a value that fell in the wrong area, you would never get a code. You'd get a drivability problem. So that's why you had to really have a really good understanding of how sensors worked, how drivers worked. So with these tools, they gave you a code, and other cars, they gave you you'd get a flash code. And you had to count those flash codes, and you had to go look up on a book and define that code. That's just the way it was. And this guy here, codes and data were like what they mostly used. And there was really no bi-directional. This thing had bi-directional. It was pretty cool, is that you'd flick this little switch over here. You'd push it over, and you'd hear the air pump go, whoosh, you hear the air pump come on. You're like, wow, that's pretty cool. It wasn't really bi-directional like we have today. All it was doing, it was grounding a wire in the connector to allow the air pump relay to engage. So they were looking at an O2 sensor. You put the air pump on, and you watch the O2 react, and that was your bi-directional. So this is what they did back then. But this tool here had to be sent in all the time. It had to be sent in. You couldn't update it without sending the whole tool in. They'd open it up, and they would update the software in it. But it did provide a window to see what the computer was seeing. As before, you didn't have a window. So that was the main thing of having scan tools that pulled serial data. And the other problem that we had in the early days was everybody had their own connector. There was no rule to what the connector looked like, where it was located, what pin was ground, what pin did you have to ground with the ground pin to get the check engine light to start flashing a code, right? So either it was flash code or you retrieved it with a scan tool to pull data. And they did have PID support, flash code, but again, lack of bidirectional controls. And there was a lot of problems with these things. Sometimes connectors would get dirty. They would fall into the engine compartment of Fords and they would melt. So they were a lot of them were in bad locations. The elements attacked these connectors. They weren't all inside the car. Some manufacturers have inside a car, some are outside the car. So it became a big problem back then. And this is one tool. Actually, this is a tool that Volvo used up to 98. But this company, I think it was Auto Diagnose. They made this tool for European cars so that you could use it as a serial tool, okay, for working on Volvos. But they made all these adapters that would plug in between the computer and the connector on the computer. And then this cable hooked into the scan tool, you were looking at live numbers. It was like it was an electronic breakout box. It looked like you were looking at serial data, but you weren't. You're looking at live numbers. And the reason why that was a better format is I can have the car cough for a half a second, and a tool, let's say you had a crank sensor that glitched, this tool would find it immediately. It would set an F code on that pin. So I was scrolling and looking at pins live. That was the difference with this tool. It was the only tool back then besides the Simutech, because Simutech was doing the same thing, but it was more computerized. So they used this cable, all right, in line, and both of these cables would plug in here, and I could go on my computer and view all the pins I wanted. But this was the interface technology through PC, and that's what it was, a scan tool. So you kind of had both around the same time, because don't forget, a lot of the cars didn't have data. So how are you going to see what's going on? And this became a very expensive venture. I ended up buying 60 cables in two boxes, and I had almost $60,000 invested in that tool. And then all of a sudden it became antiquated, and it went bye-bye. Because what happened is, as cars got newer, they were checking components, they were checking harnesses themselves. So there was no need for this machine to go in and check the wires for you. But this is where I learned that it was checking power feeds, ground feeds, sensor values. It was applying all my solenoids, all my relay coils, all my injector coils, and it was giving me all my specs, and I learned from it. I watched it do its job. So you need to have that latching before you start scanning a car. If you have no foundation how the stuff works, you're looking at a scan tool, what are you looking at? You know, so you have to have a foundation before you start using stuff. And when the Obadi-1 market opened up, a lot more companies got involved, and it just started to evolve into more companies expanding on going in and supporting certain modules that they want to support. I mean, back in the old days, there were some manufacturers supported engine and trans. It wasn't all the modules. So they just kept adding these things on. But see, when I had my tool, I didn't know any better. I just thought, well, maybe that's all that's available. Because I plug in and there's my list, and I thought that's all that's available. But there's a lot of options out there. And it depends on where your strengths are. Are you mostly doing European? You mostly doing Asian? Or are you mostly doing domestic? Because there are certain scan tools that are geared more to Asian. Maybe some more towards European. Maybe some more towards domestic. And that's just the way it is. So you would never know the differences unless you had all three types. How many guys have snap-on scanners? How many have OTCs? How many have something other? And how many have more than one scan tool? See? So it becomes like what one gives, the other one doesn't give. When one is wrong, the other one's right. So the way I see it is, it's like automotive polygamy. You have to have more than one, because one's not going to do it. I'm here to tell you that. If there's a problem with the scan tool, plug your other one in and see if that scan tool is doing the same thing. Because there is no tool that's going to be perfect. And there's no tool that's not going to have a bug in it. Even factory tools can have bugs in them. But they're fixed very quickly. And it's up to the technician to call, and even you guys to call. If there's a problem with your tool, you better let your tool guy know. Or call the manufacturer yourself and let them know. Because if you don't let them know, the next guy's going to have a problem. And we're going to see a lot of this stuff as we go along. There's a lot of shops that I have, I swear to you, that they may not do anything else but engine management. That's their scan tool. I'm like, dude, where's your scan tool? There it is. I'm like, dude, that's an OB2 generic scan tool. And that's what they're using. You're going to pull codes. You're going to pull data with it. You may look at the monitors, but you're not going to have any functionality. You're not doing bi-directional with it. I don't know. I'm thinking generic. There's no bi-directional in them, not yet anyways. There probably will be down the road. They'll probably do a lot of changes, but you're not getting the full picture. And you'll see proof of this as we go along. So it's an engine management tool, but it has its good and its bad. All right? And it's also good to have it as another tool with your enhanced tool, which we'll also talk about down the road. Now, I want to introduce you to the factory tools, just so you know what they're all about. And so if you've ever seen all data, a specific name for a tool, you know what it looks like. And I'm going to tell you that what the manufacturers have all done, there's probably like 20 of the majors, not the exotic cars, not Lamborghinis, Ferraris. I'm talking just the basic ones that you always see in your shop that come into your door. Most of these manufacturers have all moved to PC. They all have gone to PCs with interfaces, some type of interface, okay? There is still three factory scan tools that you still have to use. Now we're going to talk about 95 and up, OB2 connector, okay? They had to go to something universal so that we have one connector, not this problem of connectors all over the place. So they used the one connector. So we're talking about OB2 connector going forward 95 to present 2010. The Tech 2 is still going to be around for quite a while because there's a little problem with GM right now, which I can't really talk about, but they have an issue. So they're stuck with this tool for 2012. It's going to be carried on. 2011, that's their tool. 2012, that's going to be their tool. But it will not cover Global A vehicles, which I'm going to discuss. It's not touching Global A. Global A, 2010 to 2011 vehicles, I will give you the hit list on those guys. But I can tell you, I'll wait till I get to that point. But GM scan tool here will also cover Saab, even though GM doesn't own Saab. They're still covering Saab up to 2011. They're still covering Isuzu up to 04, cars and light-duty trucks. And then you get into the heavier-duty trucks. It covers up to present, 2006 to 2010, Isuzu trucks. Suzuki's still in there up to 2010. And they also cover the Daewoo vehicles that Suzuki makes, which is the Firenza, Reno, Verona, and then you have the GM base vehicles that they carry, which is the XL7, which is the Equinox. If you get a Suzuki XL7, because there's a special card to do that vehicle, you can actually fool it as an Equinox and get in there. And you lift the hood, it's an Equinox. So it's like a hybrid vehicle. It's Suzuki, but it's really a GM car. So that's what they're still covering. Chrysler, they went to their new tool, but the new tool only covers CAN. Now, in 04 and up, the trucks went CAN on Chrysler. The DRB3 does not cover CAN trucks, 04 and up. And 08 and up, they went full CAN. So this tool will not cover CAN vehicles 08 and up. So it's pretty much done. But from 95 to 07, I still have to use it because their other tool doesn't support it. And by the way, there's two Mercedes it covers, the Sprinter and the Crossfire. And do you know something? The Mercedes said to them, you need to buy our tool to do these cars. They says, we're not buying your tool. We need to do something here. So the guy who helped develop this tool, I met him. He told me that they had to make a special CAN adapter just to do these two cars. So I had to buy a special CAN adapter and two separate cards just to do those two vehicles. But they wanted to move on. They didn't want to make this CAN adapter work with all their other cars. But just so you know, that's the only CAN feature this tool has, is to do those two vehicles. They have to support it. So those are Chrysler vehicles also that it will do. Nissan, console 2, 95-2000. You still have to use it for cars that are still using the Nissan connector. Because I thought when 95 came, all the connectors went bye-bye. It's not so. So you need to understand that a lot of these vehicles, which we're going to go over, still are using two type of connectors from 95 up to 2000. And I got these vehicles covered for you. So we talk about interface technology. I'm going to go over all these interfaces. These are the ones I all have. This is the Volvo VCT 2000, that little square box. Then, and I heard the new software. One guy told me, I said the new software kind of eliminates this box, and you can use this guy now, which is the Volvo Dice. But I have issues where if I use 06 to 2010, I use this guy. If I use 99, is when they started with this box, 99 to 2005, I use this box. If I try to use this on 05, I have issues. I'll have like communication issues. That's just the problem I'm having. But apparently they're trying to phase this out, so probably the newer software fixes that problem. Mercedes has their SDS. which works up the present and also covers some of the older cars with that round connector, which we'll talk about. BMW, the GT1, which is support up to 2009, but I haven't really used it on a 2010 car because I have another tool that I'm using, which is the buttonology I'm using for the 2010 vehicles. So I haven't had a chance to really try this on 2010. I'm not sure if it's really going to fully work. Pierre, does the GT1 work on 2010 BMWs?
Yes, it does.
It does. Yes. So they're still supporting it?
They're still supporting it.
Okay, so that's a good thing. So that's good to know. So there's still support of 2010. Land Rover over here is using the T4 Mobile. Remember, Land Rover from 99 to 2004, that's what this tool is used for. Because you can buy the older package, but I don't get a lot of the older cars. From 99 to 2004, they're using this. And a little trick, in 2003 and 2004, Land Rover kind of like jumped ship a little bit, and they start putting BMW platforms in their vehicles. So if you lift the hood, you're going, X5. So you fold as an X5, so now you're doing a Land Rover with a BMW tool. It's a nice little trick, and you can get away with it. So, but if you're really going to work on Land Rovers, 99 to 04, that's what you're using. Then we look at this guy, the GNA 600. That is a tool made by Teradyne to work on the Honda and Acuras. But now it just went bye-bye. Where's my Acura guy?
Right here.
What's the new tool they're using now? Made by OTC?
SPX. It's the MVCI.
What does it stand for?
Modular Vehicle Communication Interface.
So you see? Another interface. And the problem is these manufacturers, they're constantly updating their interfaces. So obviously they had a problem with this one, so they went to a newer one now. And here is the Kia. This is the GDS used for Honda Kia. That's their interface, used for 95 on up to present time. There's a Subaru Select Monitor 3. It gets ridiculous how many interfaces there are out there. This is the Mitsubishi Mutt 3, which they've been using for a very long time. And this is the Suzuki SDT. But the only problem with that one is it only supports 95 to 2010, but it will not do the Daewoo vehicles. It will not touch the XL7 because it's a GM vehicle. So even though I bought this tool, it won't do some of these cars. That's just the way it is. Nissan has the Consult 3. Problem is, it's got OBD2 connector. It will not do the cars with OBD1 connector, which are still being used for 95 and up. And the GM, now here's what GM's using. The MDI, which we're going to talk about. That's the interface they're using to do 2010 to 2011 Global A vehicles only. That's all they're using for the scan tool, and they also use it to reprogram all their cars. All right, so we're going to talk about that software. Ford, if you look at the IDS, looks kind of similar to this guy. Same company, Teradyne makes it, but it's in red. What I understand is, why not just make one color to do all the cars? Do the Honda, Acura, and then do all Ford, Mazda, Land Rover, Jaguar. But they want to split this tool up. I just can't comprehend it, but they're different. You can't interchange on one car to the other. So this IDS is going to do Ford 95 to present. It's going to do Mazda 95 to present because Ford owns Mazda. Land Rover jumped ship in 05. So Ford bought them in 05. So this is the tool from 05 to present. But just have you know that Land Rover and Jaguar used this tool since 95. So 95 to present. But also let you know that Land Rover and Jaguar both got bought out by a company called Tata. So Tata now owns them, but apparently this tool is still supported. They're still using this tool. I guess Ford is making the software for them, I would guess. I don't know what the deal is made, but eventually we'll get a Tata interface. That's going to be probably next. Star Mobile, there's their interface. That's the one for the CAN vehicles. So they're making all these interfaces because they want to have their own software. And the idea of having PC software, and look, Snap-on moved to the virus. There's a reason behind it. Because with PC software, you can also latch it and hyperlink. Let's say you had a code. You hit the code, it'll take you right to Mitchell on Demand. That's what they want to do. They want to keep you in one spot so that you can go on the internet with your scan tool and take another step further. So it's all about now merging information with the scan tool. That's where it's all going. Information with the scan tool. That's why a lot of manufacturers want to go PC, and some of the aftermarkets are slowly following. It's all going there. All right? And plus, you also can include programming with these tools as well, once you have a PC. The only two companies which I don't understand, they took their interfaces and put them inside a tablet. So all you have is a cable. The only two companies I know is Porsche with their Pee-wees, and that's not mine, that's a friend of mine's. And then I have this one, which is the VAS 5052. Very slow, they're very slow. Very, very slow machines. And they have an internal interface. God forbid the interface goes bad. You send the whole unit out. It's not like a laptop where you can load new software or get a new interface. You're tied to this puppy. You're tied to both these units. To me, it's a very bad design. Bad, bad design. But here's the good thing. I didn't mention Toyota to you at all. I didn't mention it all. You think I'm going to go out and buy Toyota's TechStream when I can just go buy a cable or a box that's made by Drew Technology, Kardak? This is their product. And I think Snap-on is now selling this. They may have, maybe it's red. Bernie sells it and it's yellow. But it's still owned by one company, Kardak. And I'm going to tell you something. I have a dream, and it's going to come true, that what they're going to do is eliminate all those interfaces. They all have to go. There's no way we're going to be able to fix all these cars unless they all go. And you're going to have one interface, and what you're going to do is you're going to be able to go and purchase software. I have a dream for one day. I don't want this 30 days, 60 days, 3 months, or 1 year lock-in. It's ridiculous, especially if you're not doing a lot of those cars. So the deal that Toyota has is you can buy a full year, and all you do is buy this cable. I can do everything Toyota can do. I can pull up service bulletins. I can use a scan tool. I get updated scan tool information. I can program vehicles, all with this one cable or that box. And Toyota was the only company right now to step up the plate and said, we're going to make it cost-effective, affordable, and that's what you'll have to buy. You have to buy our tool. So I believe that's where all the manufacturers are going to go. And I can tell you, I have inside information that Suzuki is going to go the same way in 2012. That's what this dude told me.
That cable plugs into what?
Yeah, just plug into the laptop. You go online, you buy the subscription, you download the software, and it comes with the driver, you plug this in, go in the car, you're in. There's your scan tool. There's nothing I can't do on a Toyota. Nothing. So I didn't buy the interface because I knew this was coming. So I'm going to tell you something. As time goes on, you're going to see that this is going to be the future. That's where the future is. So you're buying all these interfaces. And now I hear that they're really developing this tool to move into other manufacturers. And other manufacturers are looking at it. Yes?
Where do you buy it?
You can buy it from Bernie Thompson. He sells them. He sells the yellow one. Or you can go straight to Kardak. But that I believe that's going to be the future. Because they're working on a lot. Remember that all these other interfaces have different protocols of how they work. So he has to make this box kind of like emulate their tools so you can go online and work with their software. So you can buy subscription. And because you're going to need enhanced stuff, and we're going to talk about it. Here's GM. GM went to this interface, and they decided only to do 2010 vehicles with it, the Global A cars. But here's the problem. You have to have a TIS subscription for 3 months or 1 year. And they're not releasing the software. It's not being released. Because they told me for the past 2 years, when I call them every 30 days, he says it's in a development stage. They're trying to develop it for aftermarket. But there's another problem, which I can't discuss. But that's not the truth. They have a problem. But if you go and talk to the TIS, the web people, who's the GM guys, AC Delco, and you let them know that you have a subscription, they're going to take all information from you. What are you working on? What's the VIN? What's your name? They're going to get on Facebook. They're going to interrogate you. And they said, we'll call you back in 24 hours to let you know whether we can validate you for the subscription. Then 24 hours later, because you have to go back to the shop now, I have to go back to the shop the next day, then they give me a 30-day free subscription, free, because it's not available to buy. And at the end of the 30 days, you have to go through the same ritual all over again. But see, I do a lot of 2010 cars because I'm doing a lot of work for body shops when cars are hit. So I'm calling this dude every 30 days. Dude, come on. I need another one, another one. And it gets me real pain. And once you load a software, you can use it from 6 to 10 days. The lease runs out. So you have to hook it back online to update the lease. But you already have 30 days. So you're going to use it offline from 6 to 10 days. And I believe that that's a lot of manufacturers to go. They're going to work on lease. So if you think you're going to get software, it's going to run out. So now you have to go online and validate. You go, oh, I got the software for free. Well, now I have to. It's, they're going to protect themselves. You're going to be paying for the software.
Yeah. Is that the same thing with the Toyota subscription? They keep the value for them.
Well, you know what's funny? I went to do a job the other day, and I hooked in, and it said, you expired. I expired. I looked at my countdown. It starts at 366 days, and it got down to like 1 day, 1 hour, and I went to the shop. It was like 10 minutes. And when I went, and it said not validated, so I had to break out the credit card and I had to pay him.
1 year.
I bought 1 year. It's well worth it. I'm sorry, it's well worth it for me. Oh, my God. What you could do with that is incredible. So here's the 2010 cars, Global A. Allure. These are cars that the Tech 2 is not going to touch. Allure, Camaro, Cruze, LaCrosse, Equinox, the new Equinox, Terrain, SRX, and Regal. Those are Global A. I did call up Snap-on. I says, are you guys going to be able to handle this car? Because the Tech 2 can't. He said, yes, we can. Snap-on just released new software for October, so you'll be able to do these cars. I don't know how well, but you'll be able to do these cars. They're getting into these cars. And OTC also holds claim to doing these cars. So if you get these cars, I want to know firsthand if you can get into these cars. Because the Tech 2 can't touch it. Only that MDI can touch it.
Not even generic?
What's that?
Not even generic?
Well, generic, you're only going to go to engine. You can still go in, yes. Because they have to. That's mandated by the government. You have to be able to get in. This is going in on the enhanced side. All right? And the way they do it, they're, let me try my new Zoom feature here. I just bought this sucker in New York. Let's say, wait. See, what they're doing is, you're downloading packages from them. You see how I downloaded 2010? I downloaded September 10th. Of 2010, but look at these older packages that I had before, August. So you download the package, and then you open the package. It gets delivered to you through serial, through the internet. It gets delivered to you. You open your package. This one's for Buick, Pontiac, and GMC, and this one's for Chevrolet. This one's for Cadillac. Those are the packages. Once you open them up, they load into your laptop, and now you can use them. And here's the thing. I'm sorry. Once you open it up, I'm sorry, I don't know what was on their mind, but they used Windows Explorer format for the scan tool. So you're opening folders. That's all it is folders. So now you open the folder. You open the engine folder. And I'm going to tell you something. Every scan tool you have better be doing, let's say you're in engine management, you better have 5 puppies in there. One better be codes. One's going to be data. One's going to be bidirectional. These are all different animals. Bidirectionals. One's going to be functional procedures. Functional procedures. We're going to talk about all these. And then one's going to be system test. They all better be there. 5 things should be on that hit list. So that's the one that when you're going to a car, don't just say, well, I'm going to use it as a code puller. There's reason why there's 5 things. So GM has their DTCs. Now over here they have their data, and they have their control functions, and they have these other functions. So they may put their bidirectionals inside there. Sometimes they'll put everything in one folder and call it control functions. All right? So it depends on how they want to group it. But we're going to talk about bidirectional, functional procedures, and system tests. They're all different puppies. You got to watch out for your cables, because I break a lot of stuff. I ruin a lot of stuff. When you take your cable, don't ever, ever, ever put it through the door. put it through the window. I've ruined so many cables where I hook up the car, and a dude walks by, close the door. I'm like, oh, dude, he crushed my cable. And I look, I'm like, oh, please, please, come back to life, come back to life. And I'm sitting there, I'm squeezing out. All right, it's okay. I got news for you. You break one strand, there may be one thing it won't do. Maybe it won't work on a Ford no more. Maybe it won't work on a Chrysler no more. Maybe it won't pull codes. Maybe it won't pull data. You have no idea where you did that cable. And so the next car you do, you'll misdiagnose. Then you get the next car doing the same thing. Like, oh, something on my tool. That's how you know. When you start validating against another car. So just be real careful with your cables. Be real careful with the connectors. Don't bend the pins. And also know that when you put these, when you make connections, because you're just walking up to the car with a tool, you're making connections. That tool has to fit in there properly, and that OB2 connector should not be corroded, should not have collapsed pins. So you're in there. You better make sure you have a good connection. All right? And there's your OB2 connector. And just so you know, how many guys have seen this puppy? This is the best tool I ever owned in my life. I'm here to tell you, it's like a diagnostic tool. So one thing that's nice is it gives you an extension, because a lot of these connectors are in bad spots, real bad spots. I had a Ford last week, it was right in the middle. So I'm like this, wait, let me step on a brake, let me step on the gas. It's right in the middle. I don't know whose idea that was. So basically I just took it and put it up around and put my scan tool over here. But just watch out where these connectors are put. Because you put your tool in, you drive the car, you can get into an accident. So just be real careful. But what's nice about this is as soon as you plug it in, pin 16 is power, pin 4 and 5 is ground. Some manufacturers will put pin 4 as chassis ground, some will put pin 5 as signal ground. It's important to know that. All right? So this is a nice little breakout box. Even if you want to tap off power and ground, I've had certain cars where I plug my tool in, won't come on. So I plug this in, there's no power here. I'm like, now I got to diagnose why that pin don't have power. I came here to diagnose the car. That's another job. Who's going to pay me to do that? It could be the cigarette lighter. Now I have to get a wiring diagram. So what I usually do, I backfeed it power. I get a jumper wire from the positive battery, backfeed it. It's protected. Because I had one car, it was a short. And what happened was, so I plugged it in, it went pop, there's a circuit breaker in here. It popped a circuit breaker. So I'm like, that was pretty cool. My wire didn't burn up. So now I said to the guy, you know what? I got to do one thing. I have to power my tool up. I'm going to snip the wire from the back. You find a shirt whenever you get a chance, because I have to finish my job. Snip the wire, backfed power, and I went and did my deal. So just so you know, that's a very handy tool to have. And it beats having, if you want to check the connector, it beats having to be quoting the dash and checking those pins or pulling the connector down, which sometimes are part of the lower cover. And you can't get at them. They're buried. And here it is. I'm using this interface. Now look at this. I get hired by a guy who has a, what he did was he bought a shell vehicle. It was shelled out. He put an engine, a trans, it was an Acura. I was pretty sure it was an Acura. And he put his own engine and trans in, his own wire and harness. He did a phenomenal job. He spent months on this. I got a kid in the backyard. He said, can you program my mobilizer key? No problem, I can do that. So I went over there, hook up my GNA, won't power up. So I'm like, what's going on with this tool? Won't power up. I hook up my tool. Now, one thing about an LED has an intensity to it, so when I take a picture of it, it's really showing like a glow. Do I have power at pin 16? Do I have ground at pin 4? Do I have a ground at pin 5? Is it weak? It's weak. So I said, my tool won't power up. Is he losing power or ground? I'm like, something wrong. Your signal ground is weak. So I'm like, you know what? Let me just do something here. I'll make my life a little easier. I got to finish this car today. So I jump it out. So I did. I took a jumper wire. I jumped it out, and my tool lit up. So I went in, did my job. So I saw a key flashing. So I went in, programming. Boom, it starts up. I'm all happy. I'm like, yeah. Okay. I disconnect. I go down the road. The car won't start. What are you talking about? It won't start. Dude, it ran when I left. It won't start. So I'm thinking. I said, you know what? Turn the key on, let me know if the green light's flashing. He goes, the green light's not even on. I'm like, God, it was running. I'm like, oh, wait a minute. What did I do when I was there? I jumped it. That's a signal ground. So I pulled over the side of the road. I'm reading the wire diagram. That signal ground goes from the ECM to the immobilizer to the connector. I said, dude, somewhere in the car, I don't know what kind of harness you put in, but It ain't feeding the mobilizer the ground. So I said, jump it out for now. So he jumps out, car starts up. I'm like, it's unbelievable that that tool helped me diagnose the car because it had a dim light. Had I not put my tool in there, I never would have known it was a bad ground. Had I not plugged this in there, I wouldn't have seen it was a bad ground. So you see on that thing there, because I just put one and one together. So understand that those two grounds, chassis ground and signal ground, they're different puppies. So it was a loss of a signal ground. Cell phones off, guys. All right, so here. We get a car, goes to the inspection station, and it fails inspection. 2003 Ford F-250, 5.4 liter, right? It fails. It fails because the monitors over here did not run yet. Two monitors didn't run. Misfire monitor ran, fuel system ran, comprehensive. O2 heater, did it run?
No.
Oxygen sensor, did it run?
No.
Does this thing support cat monitor? Because it's grayed out.
No.
Does it support EGR monitor?
No.
Support EVAP? Secondary air? How many O2 does it have?
Two.
Two? What does that say right there?
What do you want?
So why is the guy at the inspection station failing this car? He thought it was OBD2. It talked. This car talked OBD2. It had OBD2 software, but it wasn't. Here's the clincher here.
What year?
2003? Yeah, truck? The weight is. I'm just telling you, 2003 Ford. Was that? What did I say? 250 or 350? It says right there. Okay, now look. What's this little beautiful sticker on the front of the vehicle? Are we supposed to look at that? What's that word right there say? And look, it says here, this engine conforms the U.S. EPA regulation applicable to 2003 model year ULEV, heavy-duty gasoline-fueled engines, and meets all the applicable requirements of 40 CFR Part 82. This engine is certified to use in all heavy-duty vehicles, CFR certified, OBD1 certified. Attention, dynamometer operator. Dyno restrictions may apply. May have all-wheel drive ABS traction control. So this guy never looked at the sticker, never validated nothing. He just plugged it in. That's his job. He just plugs it in. If it fails, it fails. So you need to validate whether it's OBD2 or not before you start playing the game. And this guy never even checked himself, the guy at the shop. But you just have to watch out for these puppies.
Do idle test.
It's 8500.
Yes.
So probably that's why, right?
But I'm thinking, I mean, I don't do inspections, but I'm thinking that if you're going to do the OBD2 test, you better know if that car's OBD2 compliant.
That
didn't start
till this year, so pretend it was last year.
No,
8500
and up is heavy duty.
8500 up. So I'd like to know what it said on the door sticker. She got the door sticker. Remember we talked about a lot of these connectors still didn't go bye-bye? Here's the Ford connector, still used in heavy-duty application. So you can have this guy underneath the hood, and you can have the other guy underneath the dash. So you plug underneath the dash, you have no communication. So if you have no communication, and the car is running, chances are it could be maybe your scan tool, or it could be maybe you didn't plug in the right area. So you need to think about that. If the car is running, and you have no communication, you need to decide what is creating the problem. Is it my connector, my cable, the software, the ID properly? Don't go ID in the car off the sticker. And if you're going to ID it off the windshield, match it to the doorpost. And if you ID it, find out what you end up with. Because if it says in your scanner, a 2.3 liter engine, and you got a V8, there's a problem. The VIN was changed. So validate what's on your scan tool against what is in the car. And here's that Nissan connector I was talking about. See it? That puppy's still there, hidden behind the fuse panel. Door. And meanwhile, the OBD2 connector's underneath. And a lot of times, I get my console too. I go for the OBD2 connector, and I have no communication. I'm like, oh, God. Because my tool doesn't tell me. I can't put in there year, make, model, engine, whatever. It doesn't work that way. I have to power it up first, put the stuff in, and it says no communication. Then I have to go to myself, oh, look, and I look for the other connector. So just understand how that works. And here's the other guy. Mitsubishi does the same thing. You ever see the Y cable? On certain years, you have to put that Y cable in because it talks on one side and sends on the other. I don't understand that one. That philosophy is really screwed up. So you put one wire in one pin and one wire in the other connector, so it talks and receives, receives and talks. So you need this Y cable. So understand that this didn't go away because they, I don't know. I don't know what was on their mind. I really don't. And same with BMW. BMW used this guy for quite a while, up to 2000. And here's the other thing. Let's just say, somebody may know the answer here. I hook up to this car, over to connector, I have no communication.
Make sure the plug's in.
Make sure this cap is in place. What's in that cap? What are those? Jumper pins. So if you don't put this cap back, you affect the other end. So understand that. This cap has to be in place or you will get a no communication result on this car.
John, I don't recall the exact years, but there were a couple of years where they actually switched which pins it is that's a grounding pin. So if somebody put the wrong cap on that car, you'll think you have shorting pins, terminals, putting the 20-pin connectors together, and you're actually connecting the wrong terminals together.
Very nice.
Yeah.
So that's why when it falls down at the engine compartment, you should probably retrieve it before it falls out in the road. Good move. Because I never understood the plastic hang on it. Why not put rubber? Because it breaks off. And Mercedes, the same thing. They have their little OBD1 connector outside, which you have to look for, because many, many times I hook up my Mercedes tool, and I go inside, instead of outside, I'm like, ah! It says, can't find the, no communication. I have to go out there and look for this guy. Now, let's say you get a no-start vehicle, and your secure light's flashing, 2010 Lincoln MKX, secure light's flashing, car won't start, won't even crank. All right, you're going to hook up to the engine computer, you have no communication. So what's next? The engine is not talking to you. It's a 2010 car. So what do you think about that ECM? You think ECM is no good? What could be the possibilities of that ECM not talking? What?
Voltage supply, shorted comm line.
Shorted comm line, lack of power, lack of, what does a bulb need? Power and?
Ground.
Lack of ground, could be. But here's the thing. If you have five kids that are fighting in a room, right? You had a couple kids come over for play date, like my daughter has, and all of a sudden a big fight breaks out. You run in the room, what's going on? You talk to your daughter. Are you just going to interrogate her? Or are you going to find out a story from all of them? This car has about 20 computers on board. So what you need to do is go out to the network and talk to, you look at your scanner and go, I have 12 computers supported. Go to every single computer on that car. Because you're validating, number one, if your tool's working. You're validating if all the other computers work and it's an isolated problem. And if you can't talk to none of the computers, okay, look at this. Unfortunately, this tool here has capability to do networking. The aftermarket scan tools are probably not. I haven't seen it yet because you have to be able to support every single controller on that car. If you don't support every single controller in a car, there's no way you can do network checking. So with the factory tool, I hit this little button, it goes, look, the headlight control module, failed. Instrument cluster, failed. The occupant classification module, failed. That's the one that's in the seat for a child weight for the airbag system. The PCM, failed. Airbag computer, failed. The GEM module, he's still up and running. The GEM module's up and running. I don't know why, but he's up and running. The 4x4 failed. ABS failed. Do you think that we have 7, 8 bad computers?
No.
Do you think we have the same power feed failure on all these computers?
Could
it could be. Do you think we have the same bad ground on all these computers? Could be. Do you think we have a network problem?
Yeah.
Do you think these computers are all talking on their own, but they just can't talk to each other? Because if you take out a network, they can all talk, but they can't talk to each other. So understand, when you're diagnosing cars, things have changed now. It's not like the old days where when a car won't start, you can talk to the engine. You better talk to every computer that's there, because that's the key. I said to the guy, what happened to this car? Well, it got hit in the front. Got hit in the front? What'd you replace? Just the headlight assembly. And fix the bump a little bit. So I ask you, what's in that headlight assembly? Is that a module that just controls the headlight, or is that a computer module? Is that just like a computer module? So now, I went and got a diagram to dot the I's and cross the T's. That guy's on a network. So, I went a little step further. I'm going to make a case study out of it, because, you know, we had that last class about checking data acquisition voltages, and I don't know what it should read. I read 12 volts. I just took a reading, read 12 volts. I'm like, that seems like a little high. It could be high. I don't know if 12 volts should be on there. So I said, you know what? I said, I'm going to go after that guy there because he's the most common. Maybe it's a bad new module. I don't know. And I'm going to unplug it. So what I did was I unplugged it. Then I went in again. Oops. I unplugged this guy. And once I did that, the car starts up. But when I went to unplug it, because I had to put my hand on there, it wasn't fully in. So I'm like, this thing's not all the way in. I said to the guy, I said, dude, when you push something in, it should click. You know, you have to feel that click. So it was partially in. And what happens when a connector is partially in? And let's say the module doesn't get a good ground. You ever see a module doesn't get a good ground? What happens to that module? What does it do? It can backfeed what? Voltage. It's looking for a ground. It'll backfeed. So what this module did was it backfed voltage on the whole data network. I unplugged it, the car starts up. And I'm looking at this connector. I said, dude, the outside portion of this connector was all mangled. It couldn't properly, the latching device couldn't properly seat. And you know what this little orange, this orange thing around here is? What is that for?
Moisture.
Does it have a spring action to it? You ever try to push it in and there's resistance? So the guy pushes it in, what do you think is going to happen? Push back out. So his whole problem was the connector. Went back in, and look, now the instrument cluster's talking, PCM's talking, RCM's talking, and what's all these U codes? What kind of codes are they? They're pointing codes. They're pointing out the network saying, oh, I couldn't talk to him, I couldn't talk to him, I couldn't talk to him. And you know what the guy said to me? I said, dude, you got to take out this headlight. I said, I ain't taking that out. It's all kinds of work to get that out. You got to pull the fender off, everything else. What's I got to do with starting the car? I'm like, dude, times have changed now. You got to go with me on this. I'm going to keep it simple. That's where you were. That's where I'm going to go. But what we had to do is to cut time. I had to put my hand through the fender well. We took the fender well down a little bit, and I went back there, and I saw his connector wasn't fully in. So that's how you're going to diagnose cars. Don't hone in on one computer. Hone in on the network, because that you want to find out what the problems are out there. And with that, I'm going to show you that there's only three manufacturers. There's only three, okay, that harp on network checking by topology. Topology is going to be the future. I'm here to tell you, because Chrysler does the best job with it. The only one. Nissan touches on it. And what Nissan does, this is a network, but it's not live. That's the problem with it. I don't like it. It's not live. So I turn the key on, I hit it, and here's all the guys that are alive. ECM, forward drive, airbag, the audio-visual module, the body control module, the trans controller, the instrument cluster, I don't know what the ADP is, ABS module, the IPDM, integrated power distribution module. What's that? It's a computerized fuse panel. That's the new wave. So I know all these guys are healthy. And what I don't like about it is it's saying that these guys have a problem. These guys are not even on the car. These are options. These guys are options. They're not on the car. Okay? What was that? I said, I don't know what ICC stands for. Some guy goes, that's the Italian Community Club. He goes, oh, my God. What are the guys there? But the problem with this is, right, you get to the next one. Because I built this class, I wanted to learn more about topology, so I started testing on all the Nissans to see how it worked, and I did something interesting. I actually turned the key off because I want to see which ones go dead when you turn the key off. And I'm going to tell you why. Do you know that out of all these computers, the body computer stayed alive, the instrument panel stayed alive, and the fuse panel stayed alive? Why would the BCM stay alive? Boop, 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 boop. Boop, we'll open the door, right? Why would the instrument panel stay alive? Yeah, so they have functions, and the instrument, the instrument, the the power distribution module has to stay alive too. He has to provide power for certain things, but that's interesting. And by the way, I had to go in and hit, go in this corner, hit refresh. When I turned the key off, it still was all green. I hit refresh, that's what I got. It's a handy tool to see who's alive, who's not, because I had a Nissan one time, wouldn't start. And it was a security problem. I couldn't turn the key on. It's one of these push-button jobs. And I'm like, how am I going to get in with a scan tool? But you can, because the BCM is in control of the network. Right? Is in control of turning the key on. So even though nothing's lit up, I went in with the factory tool, and I overrode the system, and I hit a button that said, energize key. So I told the body computer, let me turn the key on. It energized it, unlocked the key, and I turned the key on. I'm like, oh my God. So because the BCM is still alive, I'm still able to use the scanner function to get in and override the anti-theft. So I'm learning now who's staying alive, and it's important. I'll show you as we go on to the next slide. And the reason I want to show you is this is the way you're going to fix cars. Talk to every computer that's on your scan tool and learn how they have a relationship with one another. And don't just hone in on the engine, because if you have a no start now, you got to look at instrument panel, which could be control and anti-theft, the anti-theft module, the body control module. You have to see what codes are in all of them to see whether your problem's not in the body controller and not necessarily the engine controller. Yes?
I was asking the Nissan factory software you were looking
for. Yes, that's the console. That was the console 3. And here's, Volvo does it too, but they do a pretty lame job. It's okay. They're doing the same thing here. You know, they have all their acronyms here. These are all the computers alive, ECM, TCM, body computer. ECM, TCM, the central electronics module, power door lock module, driver door lock module, and here's the upper electronics module. If you highlight it, it tells you what it is up here. And where's the ABS module? Can't find it here. Because I went to do an ABS job on a Volvo, and I couldn't find it in the tool. So I'm like, I think they left it out. So I had to call my buddy up. I'm like, dude, they left it out. He goes, no, you didn't. Where is it? BCM, brake control module. See, I'm a GM guy.
Yeah.
And I'm thinking, why would you call it a BCM? Well, why would you even do that? Now, this is the body computer, central electronics module. So remember that what acronyms apply to one vehicle is not going to apply to another vehicle. You better know your acronyms. You better have information to look this stuff up. Because if you're reading an acronym, you better know what it is before you go out and test it. So over here, you're going to see that these are all the guys that are alive with the key on. Oh, by the way, see it says there, update. That's how you refresh it. Because I turned the key off, and here's all the guys that went to sleep. Central electronic module, still alive. Power door lock module, driver door module, still alive. And what's REM? Rear electronic module. It's like a body module, but sits in the back. You better remember that number, that acronym, because they're being used a lot of new cars now. It's no longer when you step on the brake pedal, the body computer up front says, oh, you step on a brake? He sends a message to the rear electronics module. He's the one who puts the lights on. That's the way it's done. Less wires. So it's all done through powers and grounds and data lines. Less wires. So understand with that. Remember that guy, because I'm going to talk about him later on. And Chrysler wins the prize. Their system is constantly, constantly alive. And not only that, they're the only ones. I need to zoom in here. And networks are going to be the future. I'm here to tell you. It's the only way you're going to fix cars to make it easier. Do you know the new Audi? The Audi A8 has close to 90 controllers on board. 90. That's a lot of controllers. They even have a seat massager. Like a vibrating, it's a seat massager. So, I mean, who needs that? So you're driving the road, you're going, oh, yeah. Oh, that feels good. That's Accident City right there. I don't understand, but a seat massager, a computer for it. There you go. Now, you see all these computers? Look what Chrysler does. That's the Can C bus line. This one is blue. That's the Can B bus line. And you see the gray ones? These guys are ECU not built in the car. By VIN number, it knows who's built and who's not built. Well, the other guys just thought, well, I think he's not talking. He's bad because he's not talking. Bad. Very bad. Chrysler's the only one that tells you where he's live. Because here's the thing. Do you know if this network is shorted? All these guys are not going to talk, but you can still talk to these guys. That's the beauty of it. They break it down for you. And here's the other thing too is, watch when I turn the key off. Live. Coming to you live. Look at this. Look at all the guys who went to sleep. Is it important? Yes, it is. Because while I was doing this, I had a car that almost screwed me with the programmer key. Is this guy here, wireless control module? I turned the key off. Is he alive? Well, I program a key for a guy, get done, car starts up, and when you program the key on a Chrysler, the remote is also programmed at the same time. It's done at the same time. I get done, I leave, he calls me up and says, John, remote don't work. Dude, it's got to work. I programmed it. It don't work. It's got to work. So I went all the way back there again. I check, it don't work. How's that? So I start it up, shut it off, don't work. And when I was looking, I shut the key off, the wireless control module went to sleep. It turned red. I'm like this. It's paying off. Whatever I've been learning is paying off. Turn the key on, turns blue. Turn the key off, turns red. How's that possible? Now remember, the car was stolen, and they severed the wires on that wireless control module. And they put a new module in. I programmed the module, and I programmed the key. Shut the key off, it goes dead. Turn the key on, comes alive. Do you know there's one dedicated fuse that fed that sucker battery feed? I always thought that if you lost battery feed, the module's not going to work. It ain't so. It's only there to keep it alive. So because I saw that, I went out, I checked the wiring diagram, I'm like, there's a battery fuse for this. It's got to be. That's what I thought. Went out there, blown fuse, pop a fuse in, remote's working. I'm like this, you got to be kidding me. You got to be kidding me. So what did I use to diagnose the car? The network. And just understanding what I did. The mind was connected to the picture. And that's the only way you're going to fix network problems. I'm here to tell you. You know, going in there, checking voltage and everything else, it gets to be something that can get out of control. This is the way you're going to fix the cars.
If you didn't have that topology, what would you even look for?
You'd have to use old school tactics and going by systematic procedures. And that's why what's good is I'm learning now that, which I didn't know before, how many computers go to sleep and how many stay awake. And that's what's important I want to tell you guys, that you can still talk to certain modules with the key off, even though you can't get in. You can talk to a body computer. You can still talk to them.
What would be the parasitic drain on that system?
What's that?
Parasitic drain. Like if you're going to check...
Well, computers pull very, very little current. Remember, you're pulling more than 50 milliamps. You have a problem. You pull more than 300 milliamps, the battery goes dead within a day or two. So they pull very little amps, but they have to stay alive.
Spec is basically on the same.
Like yeah, I know from working on, I mean, Richie, what's the spec on milliamps on these cars?
The standard maximum on most cars up to date was 30 milliamps. Now some of them are running 50 maximum.
Here's my next thing. I have to have time in my hands. I like to put it to sleep and just sit, have a couple beers and hang out for about 3 hours to see which ones go to sleep next. That's my next move. Because I'm sure that they go, yes.
So you're saying I'm plugging modules to fix network problems.
Oh, I have that coming for you. Don't worry about it. Dude, I spent many hours on this. We still have tampering. You know, guys will go in the back of the dash and screw around with stuff. Maybe hook it to an oil pressure light so that the check engine light comes on when you turn the key on, then it goes off when you start the car up. There's a lot of games out there. You're going to see it. There's always going to be tampering. Guys who can't fix things, they'll tamper with the light. But here's the sad part, that you can't do that because if you want to really find out, don't use enhanced. Use OB2 generic because you're always going to see MIL commanded on or off. It'll say MIL on, right? So you're going to fail inspection. There's going to be a code in there, even though the light's not on, there'll be a code in there, and it'll say MIL commanded on. So understand, that's where you're going to get failed inspection. And here's one. Guy has a 2000 Volvo V70, ABS light is on. I'll say again, ABS light is on, not brake light, ABS light is on. Hooks up the scan tool. I'll never mention the name of scan tools. Test pass, no codes. So what's the possibility of that light being on and no coats? Just give me, I can name three possibilities. Wire could be shorted. I'll give you a little bump. What's your name?
Chuck.
Chuck, very good, Chuck. What else could it be?
Faulty controller.
Faulty controller, could be. Or sometimes it, well, I mean, well, some of these connectors have shorting bars in them. So we'll use that. So I would say either short it or the ECM has a problem. What if I tell you I hooked up the factory tool and I have a code for the, oh, look at this. Now this particular year make model, somebody must have complained. Now they call it an ABS module. Isn't that cool? Now they call it an ABS module. What code did I pull up? Pump motor faulty signal? How come I can pull it up and he can't? I have a problem with that. So understand there's no guarantees that the light is on, your tool could have an issue. This is why you need, remember, the automotive polygamy thing? Sounding real good. They do it out west, polygamy. That's what we're doing over here, polygamy. So you need more than one tool. You're going to have to. To validate your tool, you need another tool. So don't get caught in that. Here's one. Now we talk about the network, right? You see all these guys here in yellow? They have codes. DTC is present. You see the sunroof module? What happened to him?
No comm.
Right? No comm. Because I went there for another reason, but I saw this guy. I'm like, dude, your sunroof module is off the network. And not only that, when it's off the network, you see what happens to network? Remember I told you it's always good to go in and check all the codes of the network? Everybody's complaining, lost communication with sunroof control module, lost communication with sunroof control module, lost communication. Let's say you have an ECM that's not communicating. Now you're on the network, and five dudes are all saying, lost communication with PCM, lost communication with PCM. You're not the only one that's complaining. And understand now that you validate it. It's not your tool. It's the car. That's everyone's complaining. It's that dude. So now you know you're going to go to that one dude. That's why I always like to go to other controllers because they're tattletalers. Everybody's living. And meanwhile, your scan tool is nothing but a node. These are all nodes. It's just join the party. It's plugging in for the party. And you're just viewing to see what's going on. Understand that. So now I'm like, okay, the sunroof module has a problem. What's the problem? You know what this dude said to me? Yeah, man, there's a rollover. I made some money in this deal. I eliminated the sunroof. Dude, you can't do that. Those days are gone, dude. What is wrong with you? I can't even configure the car to take it off the network. Or sometimes you can. So there's certain vehicles you can configure it to take something off the network so nobody looks at it anymore. I'm like, you just screwed yourself. You did a nice job. And he goes, yeah, I mean, look at the top. Look at the top. You can't even tell. I chopped. I'm like, dude, it was a good job. But you know what? You did an injustice. Someone's going to get that car, and I don't know, man. That's trouble. So we talk about comprehensive component monitor. Comprehensive. Do you know that anything that's connected to the computer is being checked when you turn the key on and you turn the key off? I would say 30 seconds on, 30 seconds off. Could be a minute on, minute off. And you're doing three key cycles. It looks for every driver circuit to be high because it didn't ground stuff yet, so looking for voltage. It's looking to see that every, and it'll put bias voltage into all the components that it wants to check. All right, it looks to see whether the bias voltage went in and it's at a certain level. If it's at 5 volts, it's open. If it's at 2.5 volts, it's connected. If it's 0 volts, it's shorted. That's why when you get these codes, open, shorted, high, low. Those are all comprehensive tests. So understand that if you fix the problem, just cycle the key. It could be anything, not just engine management. Comprehensive is checking. When you get a code that says high, low, open, shorted, those are codes that it's checking. You have a harness problem or device problem. I'm here to tell you. You go to that device, and the best way is to go right to the ECM because you're checking the harness and the component. Don't just go to the component. The best place is always going to be at the ECM. Because you're ruling everything out right there. So here, I have an ABS problem, right? Right front speed sensor, left front speed sensor, open circuit and stop light switch on this particular vehicle, okay? An 09 Corolla. I think it's an 09 Corolla. I can't read it too well up there. I can zoom in. I got zoom feature. That's 09 Corolla. Okay, so You have there those codes. What's the first you're going to do with codes when you have them? Not clear, you clear them, you lose them. Write them down. What's the next move you're going to do?
Clear
them. Now, right front wheel sensor, left front wheel sensor, right? Should I drive the car to validate the sensor's working?
Yes.
That's a lot of work. Because understand one thing. There's two sides to that. Is it mechanical or is it electrical? So why would you put your scan in the car, move the car around, pull it out of bay, go on the road, fight traffic? How do you tell whether or not it's electrical or mechanical? What are you going to do next? You just clear the code. Cycle the key, see what comes back. You can do it three times. Because sometimes you start the first time, and it may not come on right away. So you shut off. So the second time, boom, light comes on. I know it's electrical. There's no need for me to drive it, check the tone ring, see if the tone ring's missing off the axle, to see if the axle is turning properly, to see if the tone ring didn't move back. So, or to see if the sensor was never put back in the hole and it's just hanging, dangling. So what came back? Right front speed sensor. There's a problem. How do you think it checked it? Bias voltage. So I went right to the sensor. These are little tactics you can play once you have a code, because you need to deal with the code. You pull the code, you don't know how to deal with it. So I checked bias voltage, 14.8 volts. That's unplugging the sensor right at the sensor. Now, is 14.8 normal? I don't know. So how would I know? Pick me. Guy on the other side is going, pick me. Validate on the other side. And see if they're both. So if you validate that's the spec, then you know that from there back to the computer's good. You don't have to go the other way. You already know the sensor's no good. So it's just a quick test. If you, the type of code you have, if it's comprehensive, you know there's bias voltage in there. You know there is. And you got to watch out because bias voltage could be there momentarily. Turn the key on, it goes, and it goes away. So you need to have someone turn the key on, and there's a wait period. Sometimes you have to wait a minute for it to do the test again. So just so you understand that. I don't want you to get burned on that. Then there's another code. Stop lamp switch circuit open. How does it know? I didn't even step on the brake. I turn the key on, turn off, turn on, and set that code. Stop lamp switch circuit open. I'd never step on the brake. Remember, the computer's here. Stop lamp switch is here. I'm sending power to the back of the car. Through the bulb, through ground. Right? How does it know that there's an open circuit? I didn't even step on the brake pedal. What?
It's checking the resistance on the circuit. Continuously.
How? What's it using?
Bias voltage.
Dude, I'd bump you just too far away. But the computer will send bias voltage in that line and has to see it pull the ground. So if you have a bulb that's out, a bulb that's burnt out, filament's out, it will set a code for that. It'll set a code saying the bulb is out. So I went to the wire. I ground it. There's nothing wrong with it. I ground it, and the bulb comes on at the computer. But I ask a question here. What's that yellow stuff on the module?
Junkyard.
One guy said last night, he wants to be like the same color as your truck. I'm like, okay, that's good. Part number for this ABS module is 44050-12620. All right? So we have 44050. 44510-12620-02170. It's the wrong module, but it plugs in. I found there's four different modules that year, four different. And another thing I found out is they moved the pin. If it depends on which one it is, they took the brake input pin, moved from here to here. So if you're chasing the code, you better know what you're chasing. You better validate what you're chasing because I'm like this. It's got to be a bad module. Here, give me one of these. Oh, you need that one? Okay, here's the number. He'll give you the same one back. So you better validate what went in that car, because if you give him the used part, he'll give you the same thing back. So understand about this stuff. When you get a code, validate what sets the code, validate how the circuit works. That's how you're going to fix the cars. So when you get a code, research that code and how to go about it. Another thing, too. Look at this. On the airbag system, right? I have seatbelt tensioner. Seatbelt tensioner. Upper limit exceeded on driver's side. Upper limit exceeded. What is that? High resistance, open circuit. So now you're at the component, and there's the wire there. What would you want to do? Are you going to take the computer out and own the whole circuit all the way back? Wouldn't it be nice to create the opposite effect? Because that's what I would do. If I create the opposite effect, what kind of code am I going to get now? What's nice about an airbag connector, or you could do it also with a jumper wire. What's this little thing you pull out? It's a shorting bar. Because anything that any type of coil, you remove a connector, you create static electricity. You could pop that coil off. So what they do is you pull the connector out, it's a shorting bar, shorts the pins. So I pull it out, right? I pull it out, and look what code I got now. Lower limit exceeded. I got the opposite code just by pulling it out. So I now know it ain't the wire, it's the component. Because now I'm testing the code. So understand, if you have code, a code list, and it says open, short it, you know how to test it now. I'm just getting your mind going. When you pull codes, you got to know what to do with these codes. All right? Now look at this. If you look over here, 00654, 00654, driver's side, upper limit exceeded, lower limit exceeded, same code. Is it the same code? Is it the same code? What are those codes called? Subcodes. You're going to see these a lot. Like they ran out of code numbers and they said, let's attach it with a subcode. I don't understand it, but understand that there's subcodes. Yes?
Would that work in like a 95 when it has the seatbelt sign latch on the dash?
What's that?
For a 95.
What do you mean like latch?
Well, it says like the seatbelt, like the seatbelt's not latched. So
like, well, you can actually, if it says latch shorted, you can create an open circuit. Whenever you see open, shorted, high, low, create the opposite effect because there's got to be a code for it. So now you just validate the harness all the way back to the computer so you know your problem's right there in that component. It's just a nice little thing to do to save a lot of time. And also code relationships. You get a lot of codes, kind of figure out what's going on with these codes. Now if you get O2 sensor, high voltage, bank 1, sensor 1, O2 high voltage, bank 2, sensor 1. Now I'm thinking all four sensors. Right? All four sensors are high. The readings on these sensors are high. Now remember, anything above 1.2 volts is considered high. 1.1, when it gets above 1 volt, it's considered high. So you have four sensors being high. So what's the first thing comes to your mind when you hear the word high?
Grounds.
I'm thinking ground. So I'm like, you know what? Let me check the because it's two-wire circuit. I'm thinking, maybe it's got a bad ground. Maybe. I'm thinking the relationship. It can't be four bad O2 sensor lines, but they all share the same reference ground. See it? So I'm going to check the reference ground. I put a voltmeter on it. I got 13.6 volts. That's an open circuit, right? Now, I remember last time I put my Panoma on there with a supply of ground, and it melted. So I'm thinking, you know, it started to hurt back here. I'm like, man, you know what? Not feeling good here. I got to start doing a different tactic plan because maybe it's voltage on the wire. Maybe. That's what I'm thinking. Put my Tesla on it, lights up. I'm like, whoa, that is magic. I mean, it was bright. There's voltage on that wire. I unplugged all four O2 sensors. Still on there. So where do you think most likely that short is going to be? Power to the O2 reference ground wire. Oh, I got to bump you, dude. Bump you. The O2 heater circuit. You got to find out where now. Do you notice some dude did a job on his car, valve cover gasket, and he pinched the wire right there in the valve cover, right there, pinched it. Now, I ask you a question. The scanner read 1.2 volts, but there were 13.6 volts in that wire. Why? I could buy that partially, but the computer's only seeing 1.2 volts. Is there something protecting the computer from getting whacked? They clip it. There's a clipper inside the ECM. Because engineers have to design this stuff. What's the chance of an O2 sensor shorting out, the casing shorting out, and you're getting 12 volts back in the ECM? It'll burn it up instantly. So what they do is they clip it. It'll never go above 1.2 volts because I've always tested a lot of cars. I take a test light from a positive battery, and you could touch The O2 line, they're protected. I'm telling you, they're protected. You go, oh, John, don't touch it with 12 volts. Now, if you take a test light from positive side of battery and you touch a 5-volt reference line, pop, it's history. But if you touch an O2 line, they're used to it. They're used to it. So I touch it 1.2 volts every time. You can go play with yourself. So I'm just telling you that your scan tool is limited to what it's showing you. You need reality. You need to test the wire against what you see in a scan tool. Don't always believe the value on the scan tool. That's the lesson learned there. Another thing too is, do your research. This guy had a, I forgot what kind of car this was. It was a,
it's a Honda.
And it's an 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. It's an 05 Honda. I forgot what size motor is, but his code was P2000 catalytic converter efficiency. Should he put a cat in there right away? It's a cat efficiency problem. Are you going to research this code maybe? This dude did some research. And there's a lot of resources. He found it on Identifix. You have resources, IATN. You have service bulletins you can look up through All Data, Mitchell. Use your resources. This guy found a update for this car through Identifix. He hired me, and sure enough, there's an update. It went from ZAA140 to ZAA160, and here's the update, P2000. How amazing is that? He did his research. So when you get a code, you may want to research it before you get too anal with it. See if there's something out there. And it's not cheating, because that's just the way it is nowadays. These resources weren't there for us 10 years ago. So use them as another tool, whether it be Identifix, whether it be the troubleshooting your scan tool, Pathfinder in the OTC scan, we're using Identifix now in OTC, going on IATN. You need to start researching these codes before you get yourself in trouble. Another two is, you clear codes? What are you usually clearing? You're clearing the codes. You can reset monitors. But honestly, one thing, what's between an ECM reset and a code clearing? Is there a difference?
Adaptive.
What? Adaptive. Let me show you something. Resetting keep alive memory will clear learned values the PCM has stored for adaption systems such as idle and fuel. Do you wish to continue? Because I got news for you. If that guy's throttle body's all coked up and you clear the adaptation of how it learned to adjust for it, he'll come back with a stalling problem. That's why they're saying, huh, you're on your own, dude. And it'll also reset the idle, it'll reset the fuel trims back to zero. So if it was adjusting for a slight vacuum leak over time, maybe a slightly leaking intake manifold, it's going to run a little rough until it learns to add fuel. It may not be bad yet. But understand that if it has this feature in the tool, chances are if you disconnect the battery, you may not get rid of it because it has non-volatile memory. You can't jar it loose. So just disconnect the battery, touch the cables together, may not do it. So sometimes you need a reset procedure in the tool to go in and do that feature. Non-volatile memory, kind of like my ex-wife, she remembers everything. If I could get a scanner to hook up and hit reset, dude, I'd be like in heaven. But just understand what the difference between reset and clearing codes. There's a very big difference between the two. Just another feature in your tool. Here's one, Mazda, 2009 Mazda 6, code PO600. And the car won't throttle up. Wah, 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 wah. It's in fail-safe mode. I clear the code, won't go away. I clear the code, won't go away. I can't get rid of it. I even tried the reset adaptation, won't go away. PO600 usually means a bad computer. But yet this car got hit in the front, bumper, minor damage, car won't run no more. So should I buy an ECM? What would you do?
Research.
What?
Research.
Research. Who said that? Mm-hmm. You're the man.
Bumper.
So I researched. It's always good to research. I go in and research. Look at this. I'll read this to you. If the engine is started with a weak battery, not disconnecting the battery, I'm talking, worse than you ever do to a new car. the worst thing you can ever do to any car, because you will drain all the capacitors in that car. And all the stuff it's learned, not programming software, all the stuff it's learned can be lost possibility. Some vehicles will store PO600 in memory and may go into limp home mode. In some cases, other codes will set, such as P2101. It says here, limp home mode is a driving mode in which the throttle valve opening mount is fixed in order to avoid a dangerous driving situation due to PCM failure. PO600 cannot be erased unless the vehicle is out of limp home mode. Well, how do I get it out? When battery voltage becomes too low, both the PCM main and subcomputers stop operating. Subcomputer. So there's a sub one. So the main is a sub. I noticed because when I program Nissans, it says now programming subcomputer. Who's that? Now programming main computer. I never understood it. I put two, there's two computers in there. Now look at this. When battery voltage becomes too low, both main and subcomputers stop operating. When battery voltage returns to normal, the main computer restores itself. However, the subcomputer does not. As a result, the main computer diagnoses a subcomputer malfunction and allows the PO600 to be stored in memory. Computers having this concern should have their vehicle repaired using the following procedure. Record customer's preset radio stations. Oh, you don't want to piss them off, especially set the Z100. Right? Disconnect the negative battery cable. Depress the brake pedal for at least 1 minute. What are you doing?
Draining.
You're draining it. You can do the same thing by disconnecting the cables. You're not hurting nothing. Guys, don't do that. Ford's telling you to do it. So if they're telling you to do it, it ain't a bad thing. So I put the cables together, and what it did was it actually cleared the subcomputer of its fault. Right? Reconnect the cable. I reconnect it, and it says clear the code. It cleared. I was like this. Oh my God. It cleared. CarShark ran perfect. I'm like, I fixed this car by disconnecting the battery cables. So reboots can fix a lot of things. Don't be afraid to reboot stuff if you get something weird, something real weird going on. So service bulletin, weird stuff can be fixed.
And I'm gonna,
what's that? Perform power window initialization. In other words, when you do that, you may have to go in and do other things to the car that may be lost when you're doing this power down thing. You know, it's just the way it's going to be. You got to fix the car, then you have to do other things to bring it back up. You may have to reset the radio stations, go in and reinitialize the power windows. So stuff may be lost by doing that, but you're gaining fixing the car. That's the gain. Now I got news for you. I had one car, true story, went to a body shop, and he goes, there's a problem with the windows on this Cadillac. It's like an 04, 05 Cadillac. He goes, you put the left window down, both windows go down. What'd you do? Well, replace two door shells, but use the same harness, plug everything in nice. Did everything right, but I'm like, dude, I gotta see that for myself. You must have shorted the wires out. So I went there, I hit the window switch left side. I didn't touch both. Left side, both windows are like this. Zoop, I'm like this. That's weird. So maybe they're joined. And the owner of the car there was an old Guido. Guy was in his 70s. He says, watch this, I'll show you something else. He goes in, he hits the left mirror switch. Okay, he hits it. And both mirrors go like this, zoop, I'm like this. This is too weird for me. So I call my friend at Cadillac, because a lot of times you want to call for help, because I didn't know what to do with this thing. There's no diagnostics for it. He said, John, when you get weird stuff like that, reboot the car. The logics in the car have locked up. It's logics. So I reboot the car, car's fixed, and I just haven't been right since. I always put the cables together, waited 60 seconds, put it back on. Left window works, right window works. Left mirror works. Put it over here, right mirror works. All I did was reboot the car. So you'd be surprised what you could fix by rebooting cars. And it's something that you may want to put in your toolbox, because as we get more and more computers on networking, that's where it's at. Also, look at that data. Guy's complaint. He's running this car. Well, actually, this car, key on, engine off. Where's the air temp? 82 degrees. Where's the coolant temp? 73 degrees. How is the air hotter than the coolant? And now I run the car for a while. This coolant never really gets up there. And the car starts to overheat because the fans never come on. And you need to validate. You need to validate the data. Always validate your data. Understand that it's a negative coefficient thermistor. So as the temperature rises, the ground and the the 5-volt reference and the ground get closer and closer together. So it should go 4 volts, 3 volts, 2 volts, 1 volt. That's the way it should go. So if you want to check it with a voltmeter, you can validate it. But there's another way to validate it too. What's this thing called? Temperature of my screen is 67 degrees. So the car's running. My scanner's saying like 75 degrees, right? I have 186 degrees. What's going on there? What happens with resistance? What happens when coolant seeps up through the connector? What is that? Is that nastiness? Creates resistance. You can't see that. So don't look at the scan tool going, my car's only 72 degrees. Dude, how? That's hot. No, use this. Those days are gone. Use this. Contact temp gun. Validate your data. Don't believe what you see. Validate it. And why were there no codes? It's in range. Computer don't know any difference. It thinks it's still cold, the engine. But there are certain manufacturers who now go that they'll say that we have a performance problem with the coolant sensor because we waited so long and it got to where it's got to go. So that's a performance code. It's not open or shorted. It's performance. So it's up to you to see whether it's performing or not. It's like a circus act. You're seeing whether the performance is going on. All right, so now here's an isolated case. How are we doing on time?
5 minutes.
Oh, good. All right, here. Here's an isolated case that kicked my butt. Because everything I taught you, this one kicked my butt. Guys had a code P1289, coolant sensor high input. High input. 5 volts in, ground in, it's high. Right? I look, I'm at 46 degrees. Being high, it's 46 degrees Fahrenheit. But look at my voltage reading, because factory scan tools will give you voltage and temp. So that's 46 degrees. Keep that in mind. I go on a generic side. Now, I cleared the code and it came right back. One key cycle. I went on a generic side. Are there any codes? Why not? I have a problem with that. Do you have a problem with that? Because I do. So there's no guarantee when you use a generic tool it's going to pull codes. That was a P1 code, by the way. It's not made to pull P1 codes. So there's no guarantee when you use this little puppy, which I use once in a while just for quick stuff. You know, if I want to just go clear a code. But don't ever use one of these guys to verify a code. Because it will not pull all the codes. It may not pull code that's there. And maybe if you cycle the key quite a few times, it'll set a P1 code. But here's the one thing value of OB2 generic. What's that temperature reading right there?
Negative.
So why is my other scan tool, the factory scan tool, showing 46? Substituted value.
Because the generic can't substitute.
The generic can't substitute. See, this is good stuff. That's why you need them hand in hand. I always go on the generic side and the hand side, look at both. Because you're not guaranteed to pull all the codes, and if you're seeing substitution, generic doesn't support it. But the factory tool did support 5-volt reference, which was at 5 volts. That's an open circuit. So I said to the guy, let me put a paper clip in there, because that's what I want to do. I'll put a paper clip in there, and what should happen? I should get the opposite effect. 159. Some might, dude, get a coolant sensor underneath like the water pump area. It's in a bad spot in this Ford. Real bad spot. And it's got a jumper harness. Replace jumper harness and sensor, and it's a done deal. Calls me back up and says, dude, same problem. It can't be, dude. It can't be. I found it. You ground it, it goes one way. You open it, it goes the other way. It's got to be. It ain't be. So I went back there. Now I measured the 5-volt reference. Where am I at? 5.9. Is that normal?
No.
Could it be elevated grounds? Could be. Because the ground's at 0.9, everything goes 0.9 higher.
Yep.
I checked the reference ground. It's fine. Now, I ohmed out the resistance of that sensor, 52,000 ohms. That seemed like a little high. Well, it seems, but if you did your homework and looked at the scale, it's not. That's normal. Now, on a GM car, 3,000, 4,000, 5,000. This car uses 52,000. Why? I don't know. But here's the thing. I plug it in. It stays at 5.9. I ground it. It goes to zero. Plug it in. Do you know that the load of that sensor was enough to pull that voltage low? Like it had extra amps to it? It had a bad ECM. I mean, go figure. So I did not take the extra step to validate the sensor. And it got to the point where I plugged it in, it didn't move. Now I'm jumping both sides of the connector. I jump this side, and I'm like, it don't move. It does, that sensor can't load enough to make it move. It was a bad ECM. Will you ever see something like this again? I don't know. But you see, I looked it up. I looked up the spec. At 68 degrees, it should be about 37,000 ohms. At 50 degrees, 58,000 ohms. So the coolant sensor was in range. But for you know what? He needs an ECM. And you know what? Those sensors do go bad. I've seen them go bad. CHT sensors do go bad, but he didn't need one. Look at that data. This guy, this is the same guy with that that ABS problem on that Volvo. I think it was the Volvo. Yeah, the Volvo, where it said no codes. Look at the readings on this mile per hour. 260 miles per hour. Car ain't even moving. And look at this. 0.28 miles per hour. 0 miles per hour, 0 miles per hour. You see that? You see that, right? Watch this. Factory. Left front, right front, rear left, rear right, 0.45, 0.45, 0.45, 0.45. There's an issue. If you get issues with your tool, you don't know whether it's the car. It could be a bad computer, but you replace the computer, it's still the same stuff. Hits your tool. Remember? Automotive polygamy. That's the key. You need more than one. So had I not had the factory tool to pit against his tool, I would never know. The dude was a little pissed off. I'm like, dude, now knowing your job is, you need to report to the company, let them know there's a bug. They'll fix it for other guys. Because no one is perfect. Nobody's perfect. It depends how that tool is going to pull the information. And you need to understand that. So I bring this out for data corruption. It happens. Data corruption. I'm going to go over two more slides and we'll take a break. Understand about generic codes and freeze frame. Here's the car here. I pull P108, map sensor code, PO300, engine misfire. Here's my freeze frame for PO300. It's running about, when the coolant was 51 degrees Celsius, all right, wasn't fully warmed up. The trims looked pretty decent. The map sensor was 80, so this car was running at 857 RPMs going, it wasn't breathing too good. That's what I got with OB2 generic. So now we go on the enhanced side. So you may want to look at GM enhanced stuff in your scan tool. This car has three codes. P1599. Engine stall or near stall. Why is that code not pulled up in generic? P1 code. Could that be good information to use? Possibly. Why do I have the ability to pull five different freeze frames? And this, on this car, pull the freeze frame for each code? Could that be used for validating information? Probably could be. So I have more ammunition. Because OB2 generic doesn't necessarily pull three freeze frames, one for each code. It pulls the most important one, PO300. Understand how it works? So you better watch out that there's more information on the enhanced side than there is on the generic side. And look at this. How many PIDs do we have in freeze frame? I don't know, eight? I think it might have been eight, nine. How many do we have in enhanced? 30. Look at this. I can tell you the charging voltage was 14 volts. I can tell you the engine speed was 600. The car was warmed up on this particular PID. The airflow was okay. The TP angle was good. Look at my fuel trims, negative 32. And the car ran good when I first started up. Perfect. So with the closed loop, and look at the map, 95 kPa. Key engine off, it's a 101. So now, let's look at the scenario. It runs good, cold. Start up, as soon as it goes in closed loop, is it running rich or is it running lean? Because it's taking away fuel. When you take away fuel, doesn't it run lean?
Right.
So now, who could be the most culprit that when you go in a closed loop, you have the problem, not an open loop? So the O2 sensor was bad in this car. And it falsified a rich condition, so it took away fuel. My question is this. Why wasn't it on an O2 code or fuel trim code? What did the car do first when it started to happen? Misfire. So now you have a PO300. You think it's really going to look at the O2 now? Because couldn't it be a plug and wire? So there'd be no fuel trim code. There'll be no O2 code. Why the PO108? Map sensor code, why? Because of the vacuum, and the vacuum's so bad. So understand how this stuff works. That you may not get a code for a bad component. You need to put pieces together. And you better look at more enhanced stuff. You're not going to find it all in OB2 generic. OB2 generic is good.
So, mode 6.
We hear so much about it. Mode 6. You know what? It's all good. But the problem is you need to do a lot of homework to decode this stuff because it's not a friendly environment. Yes, there's ways of using it to diagnose cars because Ford, for one example, which I never understood, took their misfire data, you know, like we normally have, like most normal companies would have in the scan tool under data. They stick it under the mode 6. I think so that you will use mode 6. But that's where they bury it. So you'd have to know the test ID and the component ID. Test is what test you're going to use to check the misfires. So, I mean, doing your homework, you find out the test ID is 53, component ID is 04, but there are a few companies out there that take away all the hard work. Because I'm not working for a scan tool. It's working for me, last time I checked. So there's a company now, you look at, that's one particular scan tool. I'm not going to mention what it is. But now Ford puts them in there. But here, when you go to mode 6 on the Ford, you see how they defined what the test is to the left? So if you scroll down here to test, I'm going to zoom in here so you can see it. If you scroll down here, these are all tested, like test ID number 27. So if you had a scan tool, you go on the test ID 27, which you have no idea what it is. You look up in a book or go on the internet or wherever you have to look, and that's the leak, check, vacuum, bleed test, right, which is number 27. Here's a vapor test. But look at this. If you want to find out misfire in cylinder number 1, you go to test ID 53, and your component number 1 is cylinder 1. And there it is, 0%. Next one, 0%, 0%, 4.9%, 0%, 0%, 0%. Do you think that cylinder 4 has a problem? Stands out in the crowd. So the misfire, it might have set a PO300. It doesn't necessarily have to set a PO304. The misfire is found in the mode 6, which I think is pretty cool. But if you don't have this type of information, you're not going to know. You have to just start digging with what you see in your scan tool. You know, so if you're looking, previous. So if you're scrolling through your scanner, you're going through all these things, and then it goes, maximum value is 156, 116, and that's your value. So, and it says here, passed, all right? Why is it passed there? I don't understand this. I don't. But the thing is, when it's all decoded for you in one area, it just makes life a lot easier. Let me see something. How did they do that? 4.0, it says, oh, so you know what? It wasn't enough to set a code. But it's enough if you compare it to all the other ones that something is starting to happen. So you see? So it has to be greater than 20. So it's something's happening there. So you have to look at each one individually.
You go back to see minimum and maximum. It didn't reach maximum yet.
It didn't reach maximum yet. Exactly.
At the maximum.
Well, wait a minute. Well, what did you find on that vehicle?
Well, it led me to that cylinder being a problem. And then what Ford has, which is pretty cool, is they have a vibration analyzer. So you put everything on a chart. As you're power braking the engine, at times, you can see cylinder 4 dip down. They don't have to hover around 0. Like it could be plus or minus 1 normal. And when they set the misfire, they'll dip all the way down. That's what Ford does in their tool, in their scan tool. So I saw which cylinder it was. I knew that was the one that was questionable. So if you saw that with mode 6, you go, well, let me just change the coil and the plug. You know, and most of the time it is the coil, because they go bad all the time.
Yeah, this was the coil unplugged here.
So you'd probably say to yourself, well, that guy's different than the rest. It's like Sesame Street diagnostics, right? Let me just replace him, because one of these things is not like the other. That's where I learned all this stuff. Now, mode six, which I like what Toyota does. Remember, Toyota wants us to fix cars. They're really in the forefront to making it easy. If you go and pull the code on a Toyota, all right, you hit monitors over here. Because look, now it failed bank one, sensor one. It says sensor circuit range performance malfunction. Performance. It didn't say whether it was open or short. It just said performance. So it could be near open or shorted, but not yet. All I got to do is hit monitor. Now, what I like about them is they're making universal language here. You see this over here? Remember the Fonz years ago? Hey. Remember that guy? Hey. So that means everything's good, I'm thinking, right? Or like one of these, right? Right? That means it ain't good, right? I just think that's pretty cool that for Toyota to do that. So I'm looking down here for my monitors, and the cat efficiency passed, EVAP passed, this O2 heater failed. And everything is hyperlinked. So if I hit this little magnifying glass, it hyperlinks to the next window. And this window here comes up, and it says, bank one, sensor two passed. Bank one heater failed. Bank two heater passed. Now, when I hit this hourglass, up comes another window to give me the details. It says that you're in the red. You're not in the green, but you're in the red. It's below where it should be. The minimum limit is 2.4, a number they give you. The test value was 0.22. So I just think that was pretty cool. And if you look at some companies, such as the Bernie Master, with his generic tool, now, he's got generic OBD2. Look what Bernie does. He takes the test ID and the component ID and puts it all together for you. And not only that, he highlights in red where the problem is. Now, I like this. The reason why I like this, the mode 6. Oh, I'm sorry. Previous. Okay. The reason why I like the mode 6 is I have no idea how much current that heat in the element draws. I don't. But it tests at the other side, and it draws about 3 amps. You see it? It draws. The other side was barely drawing any amps at all. And that's important to know, because a lot of times guys put wrong sensors in the car. I'll give you an example. One guy had a Mercedes, and he had a code for lean operation. So what does he do? He puts 4 O2 sensors in the car. Why? I don't know. But he put 4 O2 sensors. So when he hired me for a check engine light on for bank 1 sensor 1, bank 1 sensor 2. All 4 heating elements failed. I'm like, wow, you can't have 4 bad brand new ones. I'm thinking maybe there's a power feed problem. So I went and checked all the power feeds. You know, power feed had fed all 4 and it was fine. I'm like, you know what? Maybe these things aren't compatible with the system. So we put the old ones back in. And the light didn't come back for that code. A couple days later, he calls me again and goes, I got the lean code. I'm like, dude, and that was your problem to begin with. You create the second problem. So understand that you could buy a sensor aftermarket. The heating element may be the wrong resistance value. So you just create a wrong problem, another problem for yourself. It'll plug in, but it wasn't manufactured properly for that car. So you need to watch out, and you'll never know what the heating, what the amperage should be unless you're in mode 6. Mode 6 is the computer running its system test. Remember I talked about bidirectional, functional procedures, and system test? Well, these things are like system test, and certain scan tools will automate system tests, kind of like running a monitor for you, all right? So understand what system test is all about. That's a system test that was run. Okay, so let's look at something here. This just happened today. The guy's like, I got a 2000 Land Rover Range Rover 4.0. Yay, I got Land Rover software. Really? When that happened? Just happened on the last release. Yay! Okay. So, what's the deal? Well, I pulled a mobilizer code and on the ECM, and the vehicle's immobilized. So, we went in with the code, and I'm like, well, let's see what your scan tool has. So we went on there. It's got codes. It's got data. And it's got functional test. Now, this other guy, stop communication, has review ECU ID that's put outside on its own. Functional test. Everything was put into one folder. So instead of having bi-directional, system test and functional procedures went into one folder called functional tests. So I open that up and I have actuator test, which is another name for bi-directional controls, because you're commanding an actuator work, and this has to be a bug, because I don't know what window reset has anything to do with the engine. I'm here to tell you, I don't think you're going to reset a window if the engine's misfiring. Or maybe you reset the window because the guy wants to jump out of the car because it's running so bad. I don't know, but it doesn't belong there. That's the bottom line.
Sure, that's a window reset, not a,
Dude, it says window reset. Oh, well, I don't know. Window reset. Wait, what could it be?
Adaptation.
What?
Would that be an adaptation reset?
Window reset. An operating window?
Maybe. Yeah.
So terminology could be wrong and I took it the other way maybe. Because I didn't go into it. I'm like, what is a window reset?
Reset the window for the adaptation. You always know.
See, I like that. Now, I'm learning from him.
Yep.
See, we learn from each other. So you see where he took it? He took another direction. So it could be an operating window. It could be an adaptation. So I'm gonna go with that. I like that. Because that bothered me all day today. I'm like, what the heck is window reset? And it's for Range Rover only. So that's the functional test menu. I open up the actuator test. I can actuate only the fuel pump relay. That's all I got. Now, I want you to understand that tools are built on your input. And when you make noise, the squeaky wheel gets the oil. So enough you squeak, then it escalates to the next level. That's how tools are made. So you would never know what's available unless you had a factory tool. I want you to be aware of this, because if you're specializing in one manufacturer, you're going to be limited. Now, let's go to the real McCoy. Here's my tool. I had to take a digital image of this because I can't seem to get the print feature out of this tool. It's just the way they designed it. I have fault code diagnostics. I have something called subsystem test, which I think is system test. Real-time display data. We know it's going to be real time, so why would you call it real time? Just call it data, dude. So they call it real time display. Force outputs. So you're forcing something to work. We're not forcing it. We're gently telling it what to do. So everyone has their own terminology. So that's bi-directional. And vehicle maintenance. You can do vehicle maintenance. Those are functional procedures. This is what they're calling them. So I open up my forced outputs, fuel pump, closed vent solenoid valve, VVAP system, condenser fan, and e-box fan. So who decides to leave out what? Whose job is that? So I don't know. Why do you leave it out? Is it about cost? I don't know. So I don't have answers, but this stuff happens. Actuator test. Look at all these goodies in the functional procedures. I'll read them all. Immobilizer reprogram. We're pairing the modules. We're going like this. Hey, how you doing? I'm the BCM. Who are you? ECM? How you doing? We're initialized. We're buddies now. That's all it is. It's just a button to initialize. So that's one feature, which I got hired to do. Reset adaptations. Could be. I bet you they took that one thing out, put it over here, and it could be reset adaptations. I may agree with you on that. I'd have to go back to that shop and test it out. Clear fault codes. Why that's there, I have no idea. Wouldn't that be under Maybe when you're in fault code diagnostics, you can't clear fault codes from there. You have to do it from there, I'm thinking. Carb freeze frame. Cool. Repair validation. I don't know what that's all about. Open loop tune-up. Oof. Read ECM information. Now, they took that out of there and put it, made their own menu, right? Programming history, ECM checks and renewal, non-start diagnostics, and some kind of OBD2 support. So all I had to do, oh, and by the way, it's got this little guy here for a system test, secondary air system. It's going through some time. There's a picture of a catalytic converter. So maybe it's using that secondary air injection system to test the O2 sensors. I don't know. It's a system test. Then here is test results. So what happens is in the industry with any type of aftermarket scan tool, I'm not here to knock them. I'm here to educate you that stuff may be missing. You're never going to know. All I had to do was go in there and reinitialize the immobilizer system because, remember I told you, not programming software, but things that get learned and configured can sometimes get lost when a battery goes dead. I have done in the past couple weeks about 4 Land Rovers already, all for the same problem. The ECM just, the battery must have went dead, and the ECM lost its initialization. So I just go, he's going, no spark, no fuel pulse. But he was able to pull the code and said immobilized. So I went in, hit that button, said mobilize, reprogram, and said, all right, turn the key on, turn the key off, turn the key on, do this, whatever, and boom, the car starts out. I'm like, yes! So understand, why is that feature not there? Is it for security reasons that they don't want to give it out? I don't know, but just a little food for thought that you know the difference between a factory and aftermarket tool and what to expect down the road. So let's look at Chrysler's. I want to just show you the type of things that they have available on the bi-directional. All this is turning something on or off. And what's important about this is if you have it in your scan tool, you better use it. Because let's say your number one fuel injector is not working. Right? Car's missing. And the guy goes, I checked the wire from the computer to the injector. I went in and I ground the injector from inside. It works, but it ain't. The car is missing and it's not working. So I think the computer's no good. Did you try a little bi-directional, dude? Well, what? I said, what happens when an engine misfires? What's the computer going to do? Shut the injector off. Shuts the driver off. I says, so you think the car is missing because the injector's not working? I think the car is missing because it was missing, and then it shut the injector off. So the only way to validate the ECM 100% is to do bi-directional. Now you apply the bi-directional, and the injector goes click, click, click with the noid light, clicking away. Now the noid light is lighting, but that still doesn't validate the driver, because I'm going to tell you what happened down the road in another car. So you're using it to validate injector coils. You're using to validate EGR solenoid. Guy calls me up, says, I put a new solenoid in the car. I keep getting EGR solenoid code. We ran 2 new wires. Still got the code. We don't know if it's the ECM. We're not really sure. So I go there. I do an output test. Nothing happens. I check the wires. They're good. I put a noid light on there. It lights the noid light. Is the driver good? The noid light's going blink, blink, blink. I shut off. Exactly. This car had a bad ECM. I knew 100% because of the bi-directional. And you know, I got two within the same couple weeks, both Chrysler computers. They're both that silver box with just the two connectors going on them, how they all go bad. I had two in a row with bad EGR drivers. No, I'm sorry. Purged solenoid drivers. Both. Back to back. I just could not believe it. So whether it was the purge solenoid, not the EGR solenoid driver. But you could do this with EGR, AC compressor clutch. Do you know if an AC system sees a problem, it won't apply that clutch? So let's just say the AC clutch's not coming on. Well, what if you have a low pressure switch? It could be anything. Any strategy can keep that clutch from coming off. But how nice is it just to turn the key on and go click, 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 click. You just validate the ECM, the wiring, and you also validate the component. So It's the power of bi-directional. I'll go down the whole list, you know, kind of things that you should expect to see. Auto shutdown relay, fuel pump relay, cooling fan, big nice thing to have, alternate fuel duty cycle, O2 heater, pulse the heater on and off. That's pretty cool. And the rest of the stuff is for transmission dudes, right? I really don't do this kind of stuff, but transmission dudes. On the drive solenoid, overdrive solenoid, 2-4 solenoid, LC solenoid, DR solenoid, all good stuff. Yes?
Probably Chrysler's about the best when it comes to that.
Well, there's a lot of manufacturers where they leave stuff out of the scan tool. It's kind of sad that they would leave stuff out.
But I mean, even if you had the OEM scan tool, you still couldn't do all of those. Like, it seems like Chrysler has
Chrysler has a lot. But you know what? More and more manufacturers are adding more bi-directional controls. But here's the thing is, you may only have half of this list in your tool, or 3/4 of the list. There's no guarantee you have a full list.
But if you got the OEM tool, then you
can do everything. I want to know that I can do everything. So I'm just here to tell you that there may be a point where some of this stuff is missing. Guaranteed. So here's a car with a P1506. IAC valve duty cycle higher than expected. Is the IAC motor opener shorted? Is this a comprehensive problem or is this a performance problem? Performance. So it's saying higher than expected. So it's saying I have to hold the idle up a little higher than I should because the idle may be a little too low. I mean, it could be an IAC motor that's sticking. Could be. I'm just thinking all these things in my head. Could be. So what I did was I went into bi-directional and I applied it on 100%. And by the way, if you have graphing ability, use it. Because it's all about the visual associations between sensors and inputs on different, looking at an output device being triggered and looking at a reaction of what's happening in the data stream. You load the PIDs you want to look at for what you're testing. So here I'm testing the idle speed motor, the idle speed of the engine. I'm looking at IAC current, IAC duty cycle, RPM, and desired RPM, TPS, and TPS learn value. All right, I want to see what this stuff's all about. So now, what's RPM and desired RPM?
Commanded versus actual.
Desired. All right, you know what? Let's say a hot chick walks down the street. You go, whew, I desire that. But you don't end up with that. You end up with a fat chick, right? So it's the desired of what you want, and it's what you got. So the desire is 656 RPMs. That's where it's desired to be. But it can't achieve it. And I'm going to show you. So you have to understand what desired is all about. So now look at this. I'm actually commanding. What's nice about the Ford tool is they actually add bidirectional right here. See it? So I can actually bring the RPMs up. And I go all up to 100%, I'm at 2683 RPMs. So just by doing bidirectional, do I know the valve's working? Yes. Do I know the computer's working? The driver's good? Do I know the wiring from the ECM is good? Do I have to go get a diagram? No. All by doing this, I cut to the chase. So now the next thing I'm going to do is go the opposite way. Now I go the opposite way. I go all the way to close. Now I go to close. What's my closed RPMs? 868. What's my desired? 656. Why can I not go lower? Well, there's no vacuum leak. Why can I not go lower? Well, carbon restrict. No, because the idle's too high. That was a little high. It can't get lower.
Someone touched the idle screw?
Eduardo. Good man. I'd give you a bump, but I'm hurting right now. I pulled a muscle. You'll probably hear all about it on the internet. Richie, you taped me when things were going on. Do you know what the problem this car was? The screw. I'm like, dude, do you know anything about base idle, how it all works? I says, you know that little hole that's below, that's before the throttle plate, that little hole? You think that's like a hole, like a Moby Dick hole? What it is the air has to go through that hole, to the IAC, around the plate. It's a bypass hole. So if I were to cover that hole, I got base idle. It's the same thing as running the IAC motor in. You could take duct tape, right? You could take duct tape with maybe a little bit of a piece of cardboard and duct it, put the duct back on, because if it's mass airflow, you have to put the duct back on, and you'll have base idle.
So there was a
vacuum? No, because the idle was still high. I closed it off. I wanted to make sure the IAC valve was totally closing off in case of something with the IAC valve. So I closed totally off, put the duct back on, and it's still too high, and all I do is adjust the base idle. Now, you can't adjust the base idle unless the IAC is all the way in. And on a 4, which is nice, is if you unplug the IAC, it's spring-loaded. It'll shut all the way down. So I set the base idle. Car's fixed. You know what he did? He replaced the IAC motor. He got too anal.
Did you see that on your TP voltage?
Well, you know what? Here's the problem with the TP voltage. This is where the TP is, and this is where it learned. So understand, it's a learning TPS. It's not adjustable.
Right.
So if I back out the screw, it's going to learn 0.95. In fact, look, you know what? I didn't back out the screw. I should have took it before and after. But when you back out the screw, now it's going to be at 0.92 probably. But here's the thing. This will be 0.92. This will be still 0.98. Why? What didn't I do yet?
Reset it.
You have to cycle the key. Shut the engine off. Turn the key on. Takes a new value, learns it. It's got to know where it starts. That's a learned value. And until you learn that, if you don't learn that, let's say with the car running, it knew that closed throttle was 0.98, and you adjust the screw to 1 volt, that idle will never come down until you shut the car off and relearn it, because it thinks your foot is on the gas. So it sees part throttle, it'll never see closed throttle again until you cycle the key. So what is that idle speed motor? It's an idle speed motor. It's not an off-idle speed motor. So understand about this number and this desired. Just something to think about. There's so many data PIDs. You have to understand what these data PIDs are all about. And if you don't, there's always information on it. You know, Snap-on will give you that thick book that comes with your scan tool that a lot of guys don't look at, or disc now. And it tells you what each PID is all about, so you know what to do with them. Here's factory functional procedures. Now, we went to bidirectional. I want you to understand what functional procedures are. These are a function of the ECM. You could be putting in mileage. Now, certain scan tools can't do Chrysler mileage, aftermarket ones. Now they are. Before there were a couple, I'm not going to name them, could not do mileage. It's important. Why would you put mileage into the ECM when you're changing it? Not to know how many miles, not to say, well, it should be the same as miles of the car, I want to know how many miles on the car. Why would you input mileage when you're changing the computer?
Change the strategy.
Like that? For what? What are you adapting for?
Where?
Exactly. So Chrysler's pretty smart. They actually put mileage in that computer for wear and tear, because things change. You know, you're gonna want your appetite is gonna change. So I like the fact they do it, but a few years back you couldn't do that with some of the aftermarket tools. That was missing in action. Now some of them have it. PCM VIN, you're just VINing the car, right? You kind of like configuring it. You're putting that number in there. Clear variable line pressure for transmission guys.
Some of that actually locks.
What's that?
Well, if you that line. There's actually, you talk about subcomputers.
Okay.
That can actually lock if it's bad, if they have code, drive it long enough, that you won't be able to clear that on a lot of scan tools. You have to go with like the sub-module, and there's like a safety.
Really? So you can't do no adjustment?
You can't adjust it, you can't clear the code because it's so deep as a safety that it locks you out.
So you have to do the reset thing?
I wish I knew that. I would have tried that. I said,
wow. Well, look at this. You come down here. Look at that guy. Reset ECU. How cool is that?
Yeah, but that didn't clear that.
But look at this. What's between reset memory and reset ECU? It doesn't say reset codes. Reset memory. Maybe that is for codes.
That's your adaptive.
Memory? Reset ECU? You know what reset ECU is? It's like you disconnect the battery cables and put them back together. Because
okay.
I've done it on Chrysler where I do it and all of a sudden, I hear the fuel pump kick in. So I must be disconnecting power to the computer somehow, because this thing here, I hit reset ECU, sometimes I hear the fuel pump power back up. Then there's a thermistor test, a quick learn to learn. the clutch packs, right? I guess you did a quick learn.
What I'm saying is that if you clear the adaptives, that's reset memory.
Okay.
But if let's say the adaptives is bad for some reason, and you drive it long enough with that code,
right,
it'll lock you out. That's why it says counters on the other one.
Oh.
It's counting how many times you were driving like that.
Oh.
Once it reaches a certain limit so you don't burn the trans up, it puts it in limp mode that you can't. Most scanners don't have that clear variable line pressure.
Interesting. So I never used it.
It's a deeper safety. It's like a limpet for the limpet.
Very good. That's good to know. And look, learn electronic throttle. You have to relearn electronic throttle because you'll see a little lightning bolt come up on a Chrysler. The car, you can't throttle the car. You have to go in and relearn it. It'll say, all right, hold your foot all the way down the floor. Wait. Release it. It's looking at the accelerator pedal sensor, and it's looking to see if the throttle is actually following out, and it'll reset, it'll re-index the throttle motor. This has to be done if the battery's been disconnected. And even if you pull the connector on the electronic throttle body, you put it in fail-safe mode. You plug it back in, you have to do this procedure. And hopefully you have that procedure in your tool. TCC break-in, neutral, what's neutral gate test? Did I do a trans or is that something else? I don't know what that is. I never used it. What is it? I don't know. No, neutral gate test. Seems like you're putting...
like a neutral safety switch.
Whatever. I don't know. Enable rolls, emission rolls test. Cam crank relearn. So these are functions. Not necessarily bi-directional. They're functions. A little different. Here's a function. My Lexus buddy's not here tonight. I don't see him, but he helped me out with this car. I went to a shop, and there's a 2007 Lexus LX470, and it got into an accident, very minor. And the guy says to me, the check engine light's on and the ABS light's on. The code I got in the engine computer was vehicle speed input code. So the check engine light was turned on by who? ABS, because the ABS supplies vehicle speed input to the ECM. That's why it's done a lot of the cars, especially a lot of the European cars. So remember we talk about a resident code is out there making this other computer put the light on. That's why I say, getting the habit of checking all the computers. So I went to the ABS computer, and there's a wheel sensor code in there. So I validate all the wheel sensors are working. I cleared out both systems. So the guy goes, well, I thought maybe because the steering wheel's off, and it said a steering angle sensor, and that was probably the problem. I'm like, no, dude, I don't know. Maybe you need a front alignment because your thing's off. He goes, what about this other light? So I'm like, what light? He goes, this VGRS is flashing. So I don't know what the heck that is. I haven't gotten that acronym class yet. VGRS. So the one kid goes, must mean very good repair service that we did. That's why it's going to give us the high five. Yay. I'm like, dude, that's bad. I said, you know what you got to do? We have to look this thing up because I don't know what it is. So I call my friend up at the dealer because, you know, I figure he's a top tech for a dealer. He goes to me, you know what, John? What that is, it's vehicle gear reduction system. I said, dude, educate me. I said, I know about electronic steering, but I don't know about vehicle gear. Because what it is when you're going down the highway, let's say you're doing 90 miles an hour, and you decide to abruptly cut the wheel, it prevents rollover because it calculates how fast you move that steering wheel. So you cut the wheel, those tires don't move. I'm like, how does that happen? He goes... I said, well, the guy wants to line the front end. No, 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 no. Do not touch the toe in that car. That's not the way you do it. You have to recalibrate the spoke. Recalibrate the spoke? What are you talking about? He goes, yeah, you have to recalibrate the spoke. So he walked me through this. So I'm on the phone with him. And you hook up the scan tool, and it says, welcome to steering angle adjustment wizard, because it's coupled. This function is used to center the steering wheel. If the VGRS actuator has been replaced, the VGRS ECU has been replaced, the steering column or gear has been disconnected, the steering wheel is still off after completing steering angle initialization, so there is a coupling device with a motor between the rack and the steering wheel. So now it says to me, confirm the volume. The vehicle is on flat and level surface and the tires are pointing ahead. So you have to literally drive the car on a non-crowned surface and achieve a rolling point and stop the car and the wheel's like this, right? So you know the tires are straight. Vehicle stopped, engine not running, ignition on. Press the next to disengage the steering wheel. I am here to tell you, I press the button, or click, click, and I'm doing like this, the wheel, I'm like this. This is so cool. I'm thinking like, I could put it in anywhere I want. I'm thinking, like back in the old days, we used to take it off and just change the spline. Now it's done electronically. So I moved it to where it's gonna go, hit the next button, it locked it, and then all I had to do is make sure that it would move the tires. I was done. So then one guy goes to me, last night in the class, goes, well, how did it get like that? I'm like, dude, I don't know. Nothing happened in the front end. So I called my buddy up today. I says, dude, some guy asked me how to get like that. I didn't have an answer for him. He goes, John, I can tell you this, that it can happen if you leave the key on and you jack the car on a lift and it comes back down and the way the wheels settle, it can go into like a fail-safe mode and move the wheel on you. Or if you disconnect the battery with the key on and the, God forbid, the wheel's in a certain position and you put the battery back on, that spoke is off. I'm like, you gotta be kidding. He goes, John, I'm not. He goes, and if a guy wants to do alignment, he has to do alignment to make sure the rods are in the same spot and you have to adjust the toe. So I haven't done front ends in a long, long time, but he says you have to make sure the front toe agrees with the rear toe of the car. That's the only way you can tell if those tires are straight. You don't look at the steering wheel. You don't use the steering wheel to figure out the center. You have to do it all with a front end machine and look at the toe. So I'm like this. Oh my God, things have changed. So that's a functional procedure. Had the guy brought the front end place, that car would never be the same. He goes, that car would never be the same. Because he's straightening the wheel, he'll screw everything up. So just it's just interesting, the stuff that you learn out there. And then these are factory system tests. So you know like how you have your monitor test, how the computer has to run, O2 heater monitor test, EGR system test, EVAP system test. Think of not bidirectionals, not functional tests, but system tests are tests that you initiate the computer to perform itself, such as, first gear clutch test. I've never done these. Second gear clutch test, third gear clutch test, EGR system test. It may go in and apply the EGR valve and watch to see what the map reading is, right? Or maybe to see whether the voltage change. It looks for change, right? I've done this before. Electronic throttle control follower test. It tells you to hold your foot down the floor and make sure the readings are where they're supposed to be. It'll either pass it or fail it. So injector kill test, O2 heater system test, purge vapor system test. These are all test procedures that you force the computer to run to test the thresholds of what it sees, whether it's a pass or fail. But these tests may not always be in there. They may not always be supported by the non-OEM tool. And we talk about reprogramming. Remember I told you Chrysler has the best topology in the industry. The best. I'm going to tell you why. You see these little lightning bolts? See it? What does a lightning bolt represent? Now, I'm live. I'm online with this tool. The tool's online. What's the lightning bolt for? That there's a flash file available for all these computers. This one, and this one.
An update.
Wow. How cool is that? Wow. You're looking at colors. You're going, well, that guy has a DTC. He's got a DTC. He's got a flash available. The network's up and running. These guys here are not even available in the car. It's kind of like a lame network, because lame car with computers. But you see how it's all visual? And it's live, constant live. They have the best scan tool software I've ever seen. Blows away all these other companies, because they want us to fix cars. Yes?
That's not Star Mobile.
That's the Y-Tech. It's the Y-Tech software that I use with the Star Mobile. It still works. Still supports it.
You wouldn't see that with the Star Mobile.
No, because I am using Star Mobile. You wouldn't see it with the Star Mobile software. I use the Y-Tech software. But thank you, because they have to know that. That's their newest software, which is the Y-Tech software. All right? And I want to show you something else. So if you look here, the guy hired me because he said to me, the car's got a P1004 short runner valve performance problem, and he finds that there's a service bulletin to program the ECM. So the code he got was P1004 short runner valve performance. It's a little runner valve in the intake plenum, plastic plenum, and it's commanded one position, the other position. Is this driver, circuit, component have a failure as in respect to open or short? Do you think it's just a movement problem? Could be something binding. It's not reaching where it's supposed to be. So what I did on this car, okay, is I went and looked. Now here's the problem with software updates. You see what's in his vehicle right now? He's got AG. You see what's available? AJ. So AH and AI are not there. So I don't know what corrections they made with those two softwares, because we're jumping ship. We're going from here to here. So I'm still paying one price. You know, when you update your scan tool, they go, hey, well, you missed these other two. You're always here and you're always there. But wait, though, I'm over here. I'm jumping ship, and I'm only paying one price. So they're making it a little nice for us, right? We don't pay for what we don't update. So I'm jumping ship here. I was like, you know, let's just put the newest software in there and see what happens. So we did put the new software in. And I can tell you that it didn't fix the car. And what I ended up doing was I used a bi-directional. I closed it and opened it. And by looking up information, it tells you where the position should be. And it kind of like changed. So I took the valve out. I watched it move when I commanded it. But the flapper and the bushing was all worn in this intake. You basically replaced the whole upper plenum. And so the guy in class last night told me it's pretty cheap. But it's a plenum with just a plastic valve and some kind of bushing assembly that wears out over time. So just so you know, that's what it's all about. And also, if you're programming computers, you better make sure you have a good programmable battery charger. Anybody here have programmable battery chargers? Did you step up? Anybody have them? So if you set 14 volts, it will stay at 14 volts. If the coolant fan comes on, it stays at 14 volts. It just ups the amps. Because I got news for you. If you're programming a computer, headlights go on, coolant fans go on for any reason, and the voltage dips, the program goes, sorry, and it boots out. If it boots out while you're programming, you have a big problem. You may end up eating that ECM. So I have one of these puppies. And some of my shops have, I mean, I saw Snap-on, I'm not trying to promote Snap-on, but they have one. One of my shops had one. It was a new style one. It was programmable. So eventually you have to step up the plate and get a programmable battery charger. Just putting on low, medium, high is not going to do it no more. It's not. Or just put it on, off. If the voltage dips, you're going to be in trouble. That's programming. You're putting software in. Coding and configuration is totally different. Coding and configuration is you're putting information about the car manually. You're putting VIN number. It's not software. You can get a computer put in a car, it'll start up, but it may have a check engine light saying it's not configured. There's no VIN number in here. All right? So you have to go in and put a VIN number. And here's one thing. Here's a guy who puts an airbag module in. Right? I look and it says coding data incorrect. Then look at all these codes. Rollover protection controller. Seatbelt catch contact. Seatbelt catch contact. Does this car have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 bad parts? Then what's the problem? No, the computer's looking for stuff that ain't there. It doesn't know. So you see this guy here? Stop. That's the guy you're worried about. I had one. I'm not here to knock dealerships, but I'm here to knock the dude who worked at the dealership. A car is sent to you, and you got 5 codes, and you're telling the guy you have to rip the whole headlight out because you have a problem with both curtain airbags setting a code and something else, and the first code said configuration error? Dude, what planet are you on? What school did you go to? You go with the one main code. There's the key right there. He didn't see it. All I need was a configuration. So now, there's different ways they do it. You could command on BMW, The configuration of the whole car is stored usually in the instrument cluster, the engine computer, and sometimes in the mobilizer, right?
Yeah, actually, they put them in the lights, which the LZMs on some cars.
Come on, dude.
And on an old one, they put it in an ABS module.
So they're storing a file in the car. So when you tell the tool to go get it, and there's like 40 controls on the car, everybody's waiting for that guy to send it to him. So he sends it to him. That's how it's done electronically. It's a command to send it there. Other manufacturers, such as Ford, you have to do what they call string coding. This can be done through suck and send, where you hook up the old computer and you draw the configuration data out. You put the new one in and you send it in. But if the module is dead or toast, you got to do it manually. This is called string coding. I want you to understand what string coding is. Oh, keep hitting the wrong button. This, if you're putting a PCM in, you got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, let's say 10 rows here, right? You have almost 120 alphanumeric numbers you have to put in one by one, because you'll see the tool say, put these in first. You go FFF0310, and God forbid if you have your glasses on, you put the wrong one in, you got to start all over again. So you're putting all these numbers in, and you're telling the computer what is in this car. Does it have EGR? Does it not have EGR? Does it have purge solenoid? Does it not have purge solenoid? You're telling the computer what the car has, and all these numbers can be had on Ford's website. This is called string coding. Other manufacturers may just require 5 codes. Like I do an airbag module, it's 04321. An ABS, 04321. O means USA, 4 means all-wheel drive, 3 means, I'm not kidding, tire size, because you have to go in the back label and it asks you, for Audi, books Audi. You can go on sites to get the information on what numbers to put in there. If not, you can read the old module, if you still have it, you didn't give it back to the dealership, and read the old coding, write it down, and then you put it in manually. And you can do it with your tool. Because Snap-on had for years, they had the lame section and the advanced section. Because if you made a wrong move and you put a wrong number in, you can create a problem. So you can do it with your scan tools. It's there to code modules. The feature is there. You're not putting software in. You're putting numbers in. That's what you're doing. It's coding, configuring, coding. And one thing about configuring coding, watch out for this. I get an airbag light on one of my shops, repair shop, says it's a Chevy, a 2000 Chevy Impala, 3.4 liter, airbag light's on, B1001 configuration error. I'm like, all right, well, hit that by accident. So I said, all right, well, I'll go into the BCM, because I can tell the BCM to send over the configuration information. I go in there, it doesn't fix the problem. So now I know I have to go on the internet and do another procedure. You do an anti-theft procedure. I don't know why they do this, but do an anti-theft procedure, it lines up the modules. I'm going to go online. It doesn't pull VIN on the car, on my car. Why can't it pull the VIN? I get a scanner, go into the engine computer, and there's my VIN in the engine computer. 17 asterisks. What the heck is that? 17 asterisks. So now, what happened was this car sat. I guess the battery went dead, and when he went to start it up or something, he ended up with an airbag light on. So even though the airbag light was on, the problem wasn't in the airbag system. The problem was in the network, because the VIN number was missing out of the ECM. So I had to literally go, I had to go back onto the website, and I had to put the VIN number back into this ECM. Once I did it, the airbag light went out. So stuff that's learned and configured can be corrupted by low battery, by battery issues. Then the other thing is not coding and configuring, but pairing. Like we just shook hands, there's a lot of pairing. Pairing is done, I'll give you a list. ECM modules with theft modules, pairing them, there's procedures. Airbag modules with occupant seat modules, pairing them. You can't just put them in. There's a pairing procedure so they shake hands. Immobilizer keys with keyless and keyless remotes with security module. Pairing. Tire pressure monitor sensors with tire pressure modules. You're pairing the numbers. You're pairing them, saying, can we be part of your team? Because here's our numbers. Okay. Let me just sing out loud. 1, 4. I mean, it's a long number, but they're giving out their numbers and they're paired. Okay, their IDs. That's all pairing, not configuring. And this is the Cadillac. This guy hired me to do a Cadillac, right? You see, that was it. Oh, yeah. This Cadillac here, no start, in a body shop. He hires me to do a simple key job. So I go online, because I want to line up the immobilizer. I'm going, 3029. That's not what I read on the VIN plate. I read 3459. I'm like, dude, it's the wrong ECM in this car. What do you mean? Dude, you don't belong in there. What's the deal here? He goes, we had a wrecked car. We just borrowed all the stuff out of the car. Dude, you can't do that. You can't just plug and play. You can't take parts out of one car just because the same year, make, model. It just doesn't transfer right because you can't pair. It's different. I had one guy, true story, and it's happened probably, I've seen it about an easy 15 times already over the years. This only happens with a Chrysler. They get a car in, and it's got Mobilizer, Chrysler. And Chrysler's been doing this for many, many years, even the OBD1. He goes, well, this car's not running too good, and the injector's not firing properly. I think the driver's bad. And he gets in. It's like a 2003 Dodge Intrepid. So customer comes in with 2003 Dodge Intrepid, right, for an oil change. He goes, the heck? So he takes the computer out of there and brings over the car over here. Now keep in mind, that car don't have anti-theft. And Chrysler computers, when you buy them new, come with an electronic switch that's waiting to be plugged in. It goes, you have anti-theft? I'm going to stay here. Oh, no, do you have no anti-theft? It stays here. Do you have anti-theft? Oh, no problem. Bink. It latches electronically. It will never go back. So they take the car, the running car without anti-theft, put in this car, and it ain't going to start because the car is anti-theft. And it plugs it in. Won't start. Of course not. He goes, all right, well, that didn't work. I can't use it in this car. Goes to put in the other car. Won't start no more because now it has anti-theft. So now he's done. Calls me up. I'm like, dude, you didn't do that, did you? He goes, yeah. I'm like, dude, you're screwed. Well, how can I fix this? I'm like, all right, let me think. All right, here's what we're going to do. It's the same part number. Thank God. Take it out of there. It's put over here. You hire me. I will command the immobilizer to write information at the ECM and make it married to the car. It'll put the VIN number, secret key, done. So you use that computer for that guy's car. Buy a brand new computer you're going to buy for this car. We'll put it in the other car. It'll start right up. And all I got to do is configure with the VIN number and you're done. So I got a double whammy out of it. And you know what? That customer never knew. He never knew. And that guy had needed an ECM anyways. So that's how I saved him. So you got to watch out when you start plugging and playing with parts. You better, and on any Chrysler, don't ever, ever, ever move the module, the ECM, or the BCM, I'm told now. Happens on BCMs, too. All right, and here's that initialization process I had to do. I went online, lined it up, done deal. Now, I want to tell you about two issues in the industry that I ran into. I couldn't fix either one of these cars. I couldn't fix either one. So I want you to be aware of what's going on. It's a new game in town. Simple job. John, can you configure this airbag module? Been there, done that. Put it in. I configure it. I got this code. Electronic control system failure. And it's something to do with the control unit not being compatible or something. So I go do my homework. My friend goes, dude, did you look real close at the dash? I says, no. This is a guy from Ford, buddy of mine. He goes, says over here, Sync. It's Microsoft Sync. Microsoft has now entered the arena in cars. You see, here's what they did. They had a little talk with Ford. Ford goes, you know, we like that OnStar stuff, but we need our own thing. Microsoft says, hey, dude, I'll tell you what we do. We will put an entertainment center in the center of your dash, and it will Bluetooth to your customer's phone. Whatever phone they have in the car, it'll Bluetooth to. When the car gets into an accident, the airbag module will talk to our unit. our unit will dial 911. And there you go. It has other features too. So when you change the airbag module, the firmware in this Microsoft Sync is outdated. It's not compatible with the new software in this module. So now you have to update the firmware in the dash. So I'm like, how do you do that? He goes, well, dude, believe it or not, you ever hear of Sync My Ride? Yeah. Well, it's called Sync My Ride. Yeah, SyncMyRide.com. SyncMyRide? Wait, I have it down here. Wait. Yeah, SyncMyRide. SyncMyRide.com. That's the website. It's a venture between Microsoft and Ford. Now, here's the way it used to work, what I'm told. Did a lot of research. You'd go online, you put your car in as a favorite, and then once you do the favorite, up comes all the firmware. You take your USB, you stick it in your computer, and you download the firmware to the USB. You go to the car. With the car running, they tell you, for 20 minutes running, you put it in the USB slot, and you wait until the dash panel tells you it's all downloaded in. Then when you're done, you're supposed to, see, here's the key word, supposed to, go back to the computer and tell it you updated the car. But a lot of guys weren't doing it. So this is what I heard, that Ford pulled it off the site, and they got control of it. So now what you have to do is, Ford got involved. In fact, you know what? I think my tech man's going to beat him up. The tech man will kick his butt. This guy here, he's on a wheel. He's going to chase after him. So what you have to do, you have to get a special female-to-female cable. You go into the vehicle. You plug into the USB. I think it's male-to-male. Well, you need a USB cable that goes that has the same ends. You go into your laptop. You go into the front because there's two parts to this unit. There's the front part we put firmware in, then there's the back part where you put some other type of software in. So there's two little computers in there because they made the front side for the owner, the back side for Ford. We need to put both updates in. So you buy this cable between your laptop and the front part of the USB slot. You put your ALDL connector right from the laptop so you can put the software through the back door. You go to the website, okay? That Sync My Ride website, and if you look real carefully, it says here, you see the software for the customer? Version 1.3, you could download that. See the one for Ford? Version 2.1? Dealer install requires a visit to your local dealership. Dealer service fee may apply. So, here's the issue. A little hot issue. Here's our Motorcraft Service. Motorcraftservice.com. That's where we go. Here's what they have. They have this extra Magilla. FordTechDealerConnection.com. That's their professional technician society. And you see this little word here? It's called Sync. That's where you do it through. I don't have access to that. No. It's Oasis. Because Nissan has their own site called Nissan Assist, which you'll never get. You're not going to get it. It's their own little puppy. Kind of like the same deal here. And I lost the car. I did half the job. I can't charge for half the job. You know, I configured a module, but I couldn't configure the dash with it. So this is a Microsoft thing. And the last thing, I didn't finish this slide because I lost the car. And I didn't document enough, but I can tell you what the story is all about. You have a 09 Audi SUV. The complaint was the rear tail brake lights do not work. They only work in the tailgate. And there's a REM module in the right rear corner of the car. You step on the brake, and the lights work on the tailgate, but not on the brake lights. So tell me how you're going to diagnose this car. Tell me your strategy that you would use. You step on the brake. It's an Audi SUV. You step on the brake, and the lights light up on the tailgate, but not on the tail lamps.
So
on the
rear electronics
module is in charge of all those lights back there. So what would be your strategy to diagnose the car?
Can you communicate with your scan tool with that rear module?
Yes, I can.
Did you see it for input, brake switch input?
Yes, I can. And it has to have it because it's controlling the tailgate. I just used common sense.
Oh, that's right.
Right? So the brake switch talks to the front control module. The front control module talks to the rear control module, says, do your job. So when, what's your next move now?
Output.
Check the bulbs, they're both good. Very good.
Output
at the module. So then what are you going to do when you get to the module? What are you going to do?
Is it bi-directional.
You know what sucks? They have no bi-directional for the brake lamps. That sucks. They lift it out. So what's the next move?
Is that pulse with modulator?
All lights, none whatsoever, not for all the lights?
No, it wasn't there. I searched through it. No, I was using...
Vacuum?
I was using the vac... No, I was using the... The Autologic I just bought, I looked through VADCOM, didn't have it. Now, let me ask you a question. So you're on this, right? There's no output control for it. So then what's the easiest thing to do if you're at the module?
Yeah.
You have your power probe, right? What can you do with the module?
Fire it up.
I power up one light, works. Power up the light, works. So now I'm thinking, well, what's the next move? How do you think the power leaves the computer? What do you think that driver needs before it can send it out? It needs power going in.
Are they LEDs?
No. Well, I can't remember. I can't remember. No, they weren't. No, they were bulbs. Because when I hit it, they lit up. Now, here's the thing. You have to check the power feed going in because it's a driver that sends power out. So I checked all the powers and grounds going in, and I powered up these two lights, and it lit up. So I'm like this. Dude, I think you need a module because there's nothing else it can be. So now, he gets a brand new module, calls me in, and what I did was I looked at the old module, because it has to be configured. So I coded it. What I did was it's a long number. It's like 34 digits, alphanumeric. So do you think I wrote them down? What do you think I did? Easiest thing to do, PC.
Clicking, clipboard.
Copy, and I put the new one in, paste, because there was a configuration error. In the module, the new module. Put it in, done, lights all work. I'm like, yes. You get done. So I take the module out, put the other one in, boom. Lights don't work. Put the module back in. Now what's your next move? There's no codes in that module. So what's your next move? No, what's your next move?
Scan
the whole car. Security. Oh, the secure module, what it said? Module not authorized.
So you got a lot of money?
It wasn't authorized. So I'm like, not authorized. So then I made calls. Can't do that job. Why? Because I have the factory tool. It doesn't fit my business model because you have to be a licensed dealer with the tool. You got to buy the tool first, fill out paperwork, be a licensed dealer. Then you have to go online with Gecko. Not Geico, Gecko. And then you have to make an appointment with them. They will call you when they like, and they have to authorize the module to be married to the car. They're doing this now with the REM module. I also lost an airbag module job, and I lost a command control module job. They're authorizing modules. Why would you do that? And if you do it, everyone else is going to do it. So where's this authorize? Why do you have to authorize a module? They want
to
have control. So I lost that job.
Whatever happened to the Right to Repair Act?
I don't think they can cover that because it has nothing to do with emissions. And that's I got to find out about both of these things because both of these things are hot issues. Very, very hot issues. So my job here was to educate you on how to use a scan tool from the time you pick it up to the time you hook it up to what you're going to do and why you're going to do and the difference out there. So I hope all this stuff will help you out down the road for whatever venture you go on. So guys, have a good night. I hope you enjoyed it.